Brian.
Hello, James.
I thought that we'd do this pre-show in a couple of different accents, and we'd start off with the accent of the Irish.
Of the
Irish. Of course, now, it's not easy to talk like an Irishman and maintain it, because I find you talk, you turn into a pirate very quickly indeed, and sometimes, in fact, you turn into a Cornish person who talks slightly the same, but not really.
That's like a leprechaun.
It's like a leprechaun. That is how you want speak. Now everybody, you are on a live game drive, of course, and this is the pre-show show of the game drive time. Mm-hmm. And if you would like to subscribe to us, you must click on the little bell that goes bing bong bing. Every time we go live, it'll go bing bong bing in your ear, and you'll know that we're here. Wonderful. Yes. Good. Now the Irish today are playing rugby, but I've forgotten who they're playing. What I can tell you is that the Scots are playing, in fact, I believe they've started already, they're playing the Australians. Can you believe it? The Australians. And we all know how an Aussie speaks, don't we? This is how an Australian speaks. They are very definite. Now I've gone east end suddenly. Yes, let me keep going. I haven't blended, I'm okay. Australian. And the Australians also have been playing cricket today against the South Africans. And they were skittled out for just 85 runs.
South African accent.
I do a very good South African accent. It is like this. This is how you speak. There are, of course, a lot of different kinds of South African accents, but this one is the one that is the most unattractive, I find. It is what might be described as kind of a flat vowel. You know, you can't say vowel, you say vowel. And you don't say I, you say ah. So there's no I, it's ah. Like in, I got a sore thing in my ah. I've got a sore thing in my ah. Yeah. Very nice, very, very attractive. What else can we do? My gosh, there's some vultures up ahead there. Vultures. Now, if you are from a various parts of Johannesburg, you might talk like this, and those are vultures.
I can't see the vultures.
They're those there. Big birds, Brian.
I see the vultures.
They are very difficult to miss.
There we go.
There we are. They are looking for something dead to eat, Brian. Something that has died and is now smelling like the bowels of Satan himself. Sending up green clouds of foulness. That one's like a helicopter. It's hovering. You see that?
A cart.
Or a cart. It's exactly like a cart, you know, with a string. It's like God is holding a string on that vulture.
Like a cart.
Like a cart. Like a cart. And for the final part of this, I'm going to talk like I'm from the East End of London. And of course, the temptation when you're talking like this is to drop any odd swear word. Because if you talk like this normally, you'll often drop in the odd little bit of a swear word here and there. But I'm going to try not to do that as I talk to you like this. This, of course, is a wonderful accent, and it's the one I learned from the guy who looks a little bit like me. Well, actually, he looks a little bit like me, right? Yeah. Rather than me looking like him, because that would make me an underling to him. Yeah. That guy called Jason Statham, of course, who talks a little bit like this. But if you've ever watched that film Snatch, this is how he spoke in that film. And his name, I think, was it Gorgeous George? Gorgeous George?
No.
Yes.
No.
I think it was.
I don't think he was gorgeous.
He was Gorgeous George, and the other guy was Turkish.
No.
Unless he was Turkish.
He
might have been Turkish. I don't know if he was Turkish. All right, everybody. We've had enough for talking like this. We're going to hand you over to Taylor. I don't know what she's doing around here. She'll tell you when you see her. See you just now.
This program features live coverage of an African safari. and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to a very warm and windy day in the African bush. And of course, this needs no introduction, but of course, this is Safari Live.
Ready. Standing by.
Again, and welcome to a wonderful afternoon out here. It's a bit windy today, but that's not going to stop us. And my name is Taylor, and on camera with me this afternoon, we've got Viam. Welcome back again, Viam. Now, we've stumbled across a beautiful herd of impala with lots and lots of pregnant ewes. And I know that yesterday, Jamie and Brent were desperately trying to find the first impala lamb of the season. But it doesn't look like today is the day. Well, with this herd anyway, there are a couple of them that look rather plump and sort of seeing their mammary glands looking nice and swollen. And I wonder if it's similar, like it is with horses, where if they get the waxy substance coming off of their udder, that normally is an indication that within a couple of days or so, they should give birth. But you can see how round they've become. Just in the last couple of days, they're definitely looking a lot bigger than they were, and all we need is one impala to drop their lamb, and well, then we're going to see lots of these little creatures bouncing around. And I suspect that quarantine is going to be a fantastic place to spend most of the drive on, but not today. But that's all right, we've got plenty of days to come, but we're going to continue. Now, I know that James said to me just before he left, he was quite keen to go and see if he could follow up on the Nkuhumas. And well, our plan, we don't really have a plan this afternoon, do we, Viam? What I'd like to do is try something a little different and just go and bumble on a couple of my favorite roads and see what we come across. Obviously, it would be very nice if we could find a leopard. So I'm going to head over towards Treehouse Dam area, where Jamie said that she had some leopard tracks. And maybe we will have a look and see what's happening there. And of course, well, your favorite, one of the favorite people of the viewers is back, and that is Steph. And he is itching to say good day to you. So let's go over to him.
Good afternoon. Yes, I am itching to say hello. It feels like I haven't been out on bushwalk in absolute ages. And a very, very good afternoon and welcome to the bushwalk part of this afternoon's PM Drive with myself. I'm Steph Vinterbude, and on camera today we have a David, not a David on the camera. What is our plan today? The wind is coming straight out of the south. Now, for the last couple of weeks, winds out of the south have brought a lot of rain for us, and today doesn't feel like it's any different. I must be honest with you. We've got these high-level clouds that are busy building up on the horizon, and on the radio for the last 48 hours, we've just been hearing about massive amounts of rain that have been falling in the country. And I mean, it's music to our ears. The drive in to camp today was just a series of pans and puddles and ponds, and it's looking green and emerald and lush, and it's fantastic. Down at our level, of course, on foot, you can have a look at what's giving it most of its color. And that is not grass per se. There is grass here that is very obviously a piece of grass, but it's mostly forbs and shrubs, weeds and flowers that are coming up. They've come up first. They're a little bit more aggressive than what the grasses are, and over time, as you see the spring turn into summer and deep summer, the grasses will continue to grow and flourish, and eventually what they'll do is they'll eclipse all of these forbs. But what it does do is just add this unbelievably beautiful color to everything at the moment. It's just such a pleasure to be out here, I must be honest with you. All right, we're going to be heading off in this direction over here. One is because the wind is slightly at our back, but what I do want to do is sort of cut around into the valley on the far side over there, cut around and then come up on the crest of that far hill all the way over through the trees and through the bushes. That's what our plan is going to be today. Are we going to find anything out there? I'm not too sure, you know, to be quite honest. I heard James say this morning that there wasn't too much out on Juma this afternoon, and that would be a rare thing considering everything that we've had out with us the last couple of weeks. It's been fantastic. Right off the bat, have a look over here. We've got a little millipede eating some fungus that is busy growing inside a crack in the bark of this beautiful apple leaf tree. You can see there, this is where its head is, and it's just busy feeding probably on some fungus or a moss that's growing on that exposed bark. Now, not a lot of animals can actually eat these millipedes, to be quite honest. They have a hydrocyanide in them that they secrete through tiny pores next to their legs, and it sort of covers their scales. These cylindrical scales get covered in a waxy, very bitter, burning substance, this hydrocyanide, that in large quantities is actually quite toxic for anything to eat. And it requires a very special digestive system to actually process them. Very few animals can do it. Scorpions, of course, there's a whole wide range of scorpions that can eat millipedes. And then the civet is well known for eating millipedes. And then from time to time, I have seen mongoose tackle a millipede, but quite honestly, it's rare that you see them actually eat one. And they're far more interested in scorpions and spiders and other bugs. Something's got this millipede's attention there. You saw him jerk there, and I think what's happened is he tried to pull off a piece of this vegetation. I'm actually not too sure if he's actually eating some fungus here or feeding on the rotting leaves and flowers that have fallen into this crevice in this bark. The apple leaves have just finished flowering, a beautiful purple-colored flower. And what we're seeing lying inside these crevices are the leftovers or the remnants of those flowers. Now, of course, these bushwalks are as interactive as what the drives are. And let me just get out of the sun over there. I've got David going, you're in the sun. These bushwalks are as interactive as what the drives are. And you can ask us any question you want. You can use the email address questions@wildearth.tv, or you could use the hashtag SafariLive. And on that note, and while we cross over here, we're going to send you over to James. I'd like to say hello.
Well, a very warm welcome to this. Well, a very well warm. This thing fell off me, everybody, and then it's so heavy that it pulled my head down onto the steering wheel. I must apologize. All right, let me just recompose myself. Excuse the scratching noise that's going on.
Wonderful.
Okay. Here we go. A very warm welcome to this part of the Sunset Safari, everybody. My name is James Hendry. On camera today, the mustachioed woodland thumb, who is mustachioed, of course, because it is?
Movember.
There it is. Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Now, we have come to the south of the reserve to see if we can't pick up some Karula tracks, but if we can't find them, we're going to head straight up towards the lions and see what's going on there. And I don't look, if they're lying on the ground doing not much at all, then I think we'll probably move around after that and see what else we can find. But who knows what the afternoon will bring? It is lovely to have you with us. Very lovely to have Steph back out on foot. So please talk to us, hashtag SafariLive or questions@wildearth.tv. It'd be lovely to hear from you over the course of the next 3 hours. I'm now going to tuck this thing. Tuck it into my thing. Now, James Richard, you are hoping to see a leopard this afternoon. Well, I'm also hoping to see a leopard. I'm also hoping, Taylor is certainly also hoping to see a leopard. And so we have a lot of hope for leopards, and with any luck, we shall be able to deliver on those great hopes and expectations. Now, for those of you who watched the pre-show show, Brian and I apologize profusely, but you know, that's just how it goes. Now we're going to go to Twin Dams down here, which is of course a single dam, and we'll see if we can't spot something there. We did have some baboons around here, but they took fright at Brian's mustachioed thumb and flew off.
Sorry.
Yes, Brian. Your thumb is terrifying.
Sorry.
Especially to baboons. It's a glorious day. It's apparently about 31 degrees Celsius, 87 Fahrenheit. So that temperature is just extremely pleasant, especially for this part of the world. The light has been diffused by clouds all day long. There was a bit of rain last night, and so really it has been most pleasant indeed. I was supposed to be in the tent today, but we've had one or two glitches there, and so hopefully by tomorrow afternoon I shall be back in the tent, and we will be leading up to the TV show, which will happen on Thursday afternoon. I'm not sure what time Thursday afternoon. I think it's 4 o'clock. Ooh, there is a giraffe. 'Tis 4 o'clock till 6 o'clock on Thursday afternoon, everybody, and that'll be live on National Geographic in the United States. But you can also just watch it on the internet if you want to, for free. Look at that wonderful fellow, beautifully framed by the trees. Isn't that nice, Brian? Mm. Rais, you have asked a very, very good question. You say, why is it that there aren't more animals that are omnivorous? Because surely it would give them a lot more to eat. In theory, yes, it would. But it also means that you have to have a digestive system that's able to be, what do we say, gosh, I've lost my mind completely. Able to multitask, if you like, for want of a better term. So to digest vegetation only, you've got to have a very specific set or suite of bacteria in the gut. Rumination, for example, is one such strategy where you obviously regurgitate the food, just like this giraffe's about to do now, I think. If we watch him carefully, he might do it. Otherwise, he's not quite going to. He needs to fill up his first stomach first. Then you get to something like a warthog, which is let's go with a bush pig, which is omnivorous. And their gut is kind of half good at digesting vegetation, but it's not great at digesting it, and it must find other things to eat as well. So I think it's probably got to do with the fact that to get a multitasking digestive system together is really not very easy. It's expensive, and it does mean that you cannot use one or other food source to its full potential. So for example, us, we're omnivorous, but we're hopeless at eating vegetation. We'd starve to death out here very quickly if we couldn't hunt. And then if we look at something like a monkey or a baboon, they have a relatively good time of it. I mean, a baboon is largely omnivorous, but they cannot eat anything like the number of leaves that giraffe can. So I think it's probably got to do, Rais, with the fact that to create or to have evolved a multitasking digestive system doesn't necessarily confer an advantage, because the two different kinds of digestion are so very different. The enzymes required, the acidity required, the amount of chewing required, the length of the intestine is completely different as well. So I think you'll find that's why some or most animals are specialists. That was an excellent question, and I had to think on the fly to get it out. All right, the water hole's just down here. We'll just have a quick look there. Paula, you say, ha ha, a bird landed on that giraffe's head. You will find, Paula, that giraffe has birds landing on its head all day long. And they're extremely helpful birds. They're called, if I can still up there, they're called oxpeckers. There it is. And the oxpeckers, Paula, come in two different varieties, one the red-billed, the other the yellow-billed, and that red-billed oxpecker there it is. Is it still there, Brian? Yes, it is. The red-billed oxpecker is eating ticks. or ectoparasites off of the giraffe. And that, of course, if you happen to be covered in ticks, is very helpful indeed. This giraffe we've been seeing quite a few times of late. He's a very old fellow, wizened. And if we go down to his shoulder there, Brian, if you don't mind, he is covered in ticks there, and the oxpecker clearly is missing a trick. Ooh, that is quite an infestation of ticks. Oh, well, I guess they got to eat too, Brian. It really is quite an infestation. Now, you'll find, of course, that the oxpecker is not a great eater of ticks unless they are filled with blood, so it's quite possible that those ticks are not sufficiently filled with blood for the oxpecker to bother about with them. But eventually they'll be picked off by an oxpecker if they suck off enough blood. And you'll find in that area of the giraffe's body, they get whipped off by the tail. They're just in front, probably, of where the tail is able to whip. Very whippy tails. And they probably will also be rubbed off when the giraffe goes past a suitable tree or bush. It will rub itself up against them. And the ticks will drop to the floor. Gorgeous. Righty, we're just going to nip around the corner to the water hole here. Oh dear. I always find it slightly distressing to get a question from somebody called Enlightened Guru, because it brings to question, of course, how enlightened you can be, Guru. Enlightened Guru, I am, of course, being completely sarcastic and facetious. Enlightened Guru, you say, what eats giraffe? Out here, probably only lions. A very large clan of spotted hyenas could take down a giraffe. There are one or two records of leopard, big male leopard, taking small giraffe. So that's possible. But it would normally only be lions. And often lion prides become specialists in eating certain things, and the Nkuhumas certainly of late have become absolute specialists at devouring buffalo, and they've eaten a huge number of buffalo over the last little while. But you'll find that they don't go for giraffe. They've certainly eaten giraffe before, they've certainly killed them before, but at the moment they're real buffalo specialists. And mercifully for the giraffe of this area, there aren't any real sort of giraffe specialist prides here. Where I used to work, up at Dingala, which is about 50 kilometers to the north of us here, there was a big pride of lions, and they used to specialize in hunting giraffe. There's 24 of them, and they used to take giraffe down sort of once every 2 weeks or so. There you are, Enlightened Guru. I like to say Guru a lot, you see, so that's why every time I mention your question, I will say Enlightened Guru. Brian, do you like to say Guru?
Guru.
You see, it isn't a very satisfying word to say, is it not? Nothing at Twin Dams Dam. So we'll head back up towards the lions, I think. Right, Stefan Winterboer apparently is lying on his belly on the floor, I think. So let's go and find out if he's getting prickles in his tummy.
I was lying on my belly on the floor, but then I decided to sit up because our subject ran away. What we're having a look at here is there's a colony of harvester termites that we're sitting on right now. And you're looking at one of their exploration holes right here. And we're having a look at all these workers that are coming out and basically harvesting any piece of material that they can. Now, what amazed me through this whole drought that we had now was the ability, look what we've just found now, was the ability of these harvested termites to actually have and collect, even in a place that looked absolutely desolate. They'd collect enough in an evening to even have some left over from the night before. But what this is not something from termites. This is something made up of a collection of thorns. As you can see, there's the sharp end of the acacia thorn. And on this side, they've been chewed through and then carefully arranged in a circular pattern. Is the light okay here for you, Dan?
Yes. Yeah.
Carefully arranged in a circular pattern and then stuck together with silk. And this is the cocoon of a bagworm. Now, a bagworm is a very interesting little caterpillar that lives inside these homes of thorns or sticks. There's many, many different types of bagworms. And what they do is they live inside these homes and they hunt for things that come past them. And they use the sticks to camouflage their dwellings. Now, this one obviously doesn't have a bagworm in. What probably happened was the stick that it was on was eaten by an elephant and it then died. So what we're going to do is see if I can open it for you and see if there's anything in here. Now, the silk that these bagworms make these homes from is, for me at least, one of the strongest materials out here. It can be torn pretty easily, except for when you go lengthways. Have a look at that. That I'm pretty much pulling as hard as I can, and that's a flimsy little piece there. I think what we're going to have to do is try and see if we can split it open. I wouldn't obviously do this to a bagworm that was still in residence. That would be rude. But let's just have a look at what these fantastic homes look like on the inside. There you go. So proof that the bagworm wasn't in residence. Not that I was worried, of course. Only a little bit. And you can see how they stick the thorns on the outside, like that. Have a look at that, and have a look at how finely woven that silk is. I mean, it must have taken an absolute age to get that fine. It's almost like material. Very, very cool. I'll be putting this in my pocket so that we can take it to James's tent for you over the next couple of days. You can dissect it some more. Alrighty, let's see what these termites have gotten up to. I think I may have lain all over their hole. I think that's exactly what I did. Now, Aaron, you've asked me all the way from New Zealand, what is the favorite time of year that I like doing bushwalks in? Aaron, my favorite time, I have two favorite times in actual fact. I have a favorite time in May. And I like May because all the grass has started to lie flat and the animals have started to come together at watering holes. But there's still a lot of life. There's still a lot of things going on. Smaller insects, bagworms, for instance. And I also like January. And the reason why I like January is just the absolute sheer profusion of life that January brings with it. There's just nothing like this place that I've been to outside of the tropics that has the diversity and this buzz that's around it, and that for me is just fantastic. So over the next couple of months, you'll watch as my interest goes from not being stepped on by every elephant in the Sabi Sands to finding the most amazing things around the bush here for you. And it's going to be quite an interesting journey over the next couple of months. So from January to May, my favorite times, with the rest of the year just peppered up, you know, trying not to get squashed by anything. All right, let's carry on with the bushwalk. We are planning on going through the dip in front of us a little bit over here. Right now we're walking on a seep line, and basically what a seep line is, it's a marshy area that would start to leak water when the bush is saturated. So it's going to be interesting this year to see when the crests are saturated enough so that the water starts to leak out of these seep lines. And you'll see where we're walking now will actually be covered in a thin layer of water where we are walking now. This by January or February will be covered in a very thin layer of water. Now, we are going to send you over to Mr. Hendry, who has a big hairy surprise for you, I think.
A big hairy surprise indeed. Now, this is a male lion, of course, and he's not on his own. And I think he's Tinyor. Brian said Tinyor was with the Ngahuma pride earlier today, so maybe Tinyor's done a bit of a walkabout, or this is another lion. But he's now gone, of course, completely and utterly flat, as has his cohort. Now, these guys apparently were mating today, this morning, and the distressing thing for me about this whole situation, of course, if we go back to Mrs. Lion, is that she continues. Is that mud or is it what I think it is?
It's the mange.
It's the mange. She is covered in the mange, everybody, which is, does not bode well if she is now breeding again, because it almost certainly then she will give it to her cubs. Now, I think this is interesting, because clearly the Nkuhuma pride has got some kind of natural resistance to this disease that these lions simply don't. And that's not to say that she won't develop the antibodies and then survive it. But, I mean, that's now... this pride has had this disease for a long time. Now, we're trying out something very new today, and that is a game that we're going to play today. You see how that rhymed, Brian? It was very impressive, I think. Ooh, the sun is bright. We're going to try out a new game today, everybody, and that game is called...
Oh. Audio has died.
Hello? Can you hear me?
No.
I turned my microphone off.
No, James.
I'm sorry.
No,
now it's on. Okay, sorry about that, everybody. We're playing a game today called Two Truths and One Lie, and that means that I will tell you two truths, and then I will tell you, Brian?
One lie.
Yes, but it won't be in that order. Oh, no. Which means you're going to have to decide which one is a truth and which one is a lie. Now, for most of you who are regular viewers of the show, I think you'll find this pretty obvious and pretty easy. But those who are going to be watching the television come Thursday might be a little bit more tricked by it. So we'll go back to this lioness, and I'm going to tell you three things about mange. The first thing that I'm going to tell you about mange is that human beings, too, can get mange. It's not called mange, it's called something else, but human beings can get mange. That is fact number one. The second fact is that mange is caused by the same virus that causes chickenpox. That is the second fact about mange. And the third fact is that mange, once you get it once, you will not get it again. So there are your three facts about mange. Now, anybody who's been watching for more than the last 3.5 minutes will probably get that correct. So now what you need to do is hashtag Safari Live. You can just hashtag which one is the lie. I would hashtag Safari Live and then write mange. And then you can write 1, 2, or 3 as to which one was the lie. 1, mange can be caught by human beings. 2, it's caused by the virus that causes chickenpox. 3, the animals will only ever get it once. Now, what's interesting about this fellow as well, I must tell you, is that he also has got... it might just be the scars from when he had it first. I think he was probably the lion that had that dreadful outbreak. Remember, initially he had his whole belly was completely scarred and raw. And I think that might well be this lion. And he still looks pretty scarred. But he's not scratching at all. She's not scratching either. Which is quite interesting. Anyway, everybody, that is the game. Two truths and one
lie.
Well done, Brian. Right, while you're considering which great untruth I've just spoken to you, let's head across to Taylor, who's got something that the lions here like to eat only normally when they're young and succulent.
That's terrible, James. We have got a beautiful herd of zebra, and well, I'm glad we've managed to get them to settle down, because when we first arrived, well, they raced away from us, like they were trying out to be a thoroughbred, bred for the racing. They were going quite quickly. And pretty much every other animal that we've seen this afternoon has run away from us. So I'm happy that this lot decided to settle down just for a moment, though, so we can have a quick glimpse. You can see they look as though they're about to jump into a sprint again. They're moving quite quickly. And well, all those little foals hanging at the back of the herd, like VM says they're going to be old news, last year's news, once we get the new foals come through this year. And I haven't seen any females that look particularly fat in this herd. A couple of them rather plump, but not busting at the seams like we've seen a couple of the mares looking like. And I'm just happy to see how healthy they're looking. Oh, that little one's having a scratch. A very clever technique that the horses and, well, most of the animals, the various equus from the antelope, you name it, they all make use of a bendy tree that they can walk over and scratch their bellies with. I think that that's quite clever. And it's always funny when the little ones do it, of course. They do a little bum wiggle as they scratch themselves. Now, there's lots of nice new grass coming through here. So we've seen a lot of animals actually on this northwestern corner. You can see there a couple of long shoots coming through. And I suspect we're going to see a couple of wildebeest too around this area. I don't think that they'll be too far behind the zebra. So we'll keep an eye out for them. Because we better make the most of it. Because I think that once the grass comes through in different areas, we're going to have to say goodbye to some of these beautiful gregarious species of antelope. Still having a scratch. And that's the only problem once you've had lots and lots of rain all over the Sabi sand, is that everything scatters. And we've been so lucky to see such a variety of animals. Are you guys also not enjoying the wind this afternoon? I don't blame you. I struggle to even hear Viam talk to me, and he's only sitting half a meter behind me. Oh, having very good at reversing, as you can see, the zebra. Isn't this just lovely? And all their manes are sticking up nice and straight, so we know how healthy they are. Now we're looking at the zebra, and look how beautiful it is. This is a lovely shot there, Viam. Very, very nice, with a spiky mane that sort of looks like what I look like with my hair first thing in the morning. Now, Thomas, you were wondering if anybody has ever tried to domesticate a zebra before. There have been many attempts, however, not too many successful attempts. They don't seem to be enjoyed being domesticated and working. They don't also have as strong of a back as a normal horse does. So for riding, they're not really great. And of course, then to be able to pull a cart, there's been a couple of people who have tried that. But good luck to you trying to put a halter or a bridle on a zebra, because I suspect you'll be kicked and bitten like you will not believe. And I've mentioned this before, but a friend of mine actually tried to hand rear a mesh, like a foal, sorry, I'm trying to go into first gear, and unfortunately the mare died giving birth. So they saved the foal, and well, they thought it was a blessing. What a nightmare it was. As that thing got older, it kicked and it bit, and it demanded if you did not give a bottle, well, and to try and feed it as it got older too got quite difficult, got very feisty, and you wouldn't want to end up on the wrong end. What I want to do now is, as we're in the wind, we're just quite close to Sydney's Dam. I just want to have a look and see if there's anything happening around there, and then we shall continue. I'm going to probably just check the boundary, have a look at a couple of dams. But because of all that rain that we've had, all the mud wallows are going to be filled right to the brim again. So I don't know if we're going to get all the big animals coming in for a drink at the specific watering holes. It's something else that's quite difficult. Let's see what's up ahead. I've already seen one impala who was standing on the road but took one look at us and ran away. Let's see who else we've got. Oh, here we go. Here's the dam coming up now. Hello, warthog. Warthog, don't run away from us. There's a warthog also trying out to be a thoroughbred, but not really hanging around. You can just see it. Here it is. You go back slightly, and I think we may get a view. Here we go. Hello, Mrs. Warthog. And isn't this exciting? Not only are we seeing the impala with the big bellies, but you can clearly see that the sow has got little piglets inside of her. Now that's one of my favorite things, is all the little piglets that we will hopefully see soon running around. And off she goes. She looked like she was rolling in the mud. Let's poke our heads a little bit further forward and see what else we've got. I want to get a better view of the dam. And I apologize if I'm sort of closing one eye. I got some sunblock in it, and it doesn't seem to want to sort of get out of my eye now. It's burning. Not much at the watering hole. It's looking still a bit grim here, but you can see a couple of impala in the distance, a few waterbuck, a wildebeest right at the back. Very typical to see around a watering hole. But that seems to be it. I think we might have missed them coming down for a drink, and well, they've all got their heads down having something to eat. But it seems as though Steph is back in full force this afternoon, and he's got one of his wonderful creepy crawlies for you to see.
Just have a look at the story of gluttony and, I don't know, wanton destruction, I could say. This is a caterpillar. It is a hairy caterpillar. Wow, look at that. Now, I was wanting to know if you could tell me what that caterpillar is doing. That is an incredibly interesting behavior, that. So you think to yourselves, why would a caterpillar covered in these hairs be flicking himself from side to side like that? No? Clue? The answer lies in the fact that these hairs are super irritant. So what that caterpillar is hoping to do is, as he saw me moving up to the bush, he thought that I was going to come and obviously take him, and he started to flick his head around from side to side, hoping to embed these hairs into my face or into my hand as I went out to touch him. And those hairs would cause a massive histamine release in my body, which will create some swelling and a lot of pain, and I would hopefully then leave him alone. And that's what he's doing here. Isn't that an interesting behavior? That was really cool. And he actually saw me coming. There was no ways he could have done another thing coming. So he actually saw me arrive. Now this particular caterpillar, I think, is a caterpillar of a moth. Only because the really big caterpillars like this for butterflies are all greenish in color. But just have a look at him going at this last little center leaf. And I'm going to show you something now while he finishes this off. Have a look at this little center plant here. There he goes on another flicking escapade. Sorry, guy. Luckily, he can't spray those hairs off. Otherwise, I'd be in a lot of trouble over here. But have a look at this bush. He has managed to eat every single leaf on this entire tree. This is a senna tree. And we use sennas as a mild laxative. In actual fact, the product called Sennacot comes from this particular tree, or from compounds that are contained within this particular tree. But this caterpillar hasn't only just finished all the leaves on this particular tree, but it's also finished all the leaves on this particular tree. This caterpillar was probably born here, ate all the leaves on this tree, and then moved across and came and finished all the leaves on this tree. And if he's not quite at the point he needs to be before he needs to pupate, he'll move over to the tree that David's busy struggling with over there at the moment. And he will eat all of these leaves as well. Isn't that crazy that just one caterpillar can do so much damage? Now, a lot of you have been asking me while we've been talking about that, if that flicking of the head was some sort of defensive move. And that's absolutely correct. So that is exactly what it was doing. It saw me coming, it then released the hold of itself on the front, and it started to flick around that very hairy head of his in an effort to drive those hairs into a would-be attacker, hoping to drive those hairs into my face or my hands as I was picking him up. And in some cases, the burn that's associated with these caterpillars' hairs is just absolutely intense. And I would imagine that with this caterpillar resorting instantaneously to flicking its hairs like that, it's not going to be a fun time if you get those in your face. All right. We're going to leave him to finish off his tree, carry on with our walk, and James has got something he'd like to show you.
Now, everybody, that is a remarkable little thing. It is called a plated lizard. Now, I'm in two minds as to which plated lizard it is, but I think that it is a juvenile giant plated lizard because they are supposed to have black with yellow spots on the back and bars. There's no bars on the sides. It is black on the back, though, with yellow spots, isn't it? Let's go with giant plated lizard juvenile, everybody, but it could equally be a rough-scaled plated lizard, quite possibly. I will try and reverse a little bit, Brian. You'll notice that Brian is whispering because we just don't want to frighten it. It's quite by chance we've managed to get any shot at all. Ooh, this might be quite a good shot, Brian. I'm just going to keep going. Go for broke. Dum. That is fantastic. How cool is that? So anybody who has a better idea of what this thing is, giant plated lizard, juvenile, or perhaps rough-scaled plated lizard, you know, my initial instinct was rough-scaled plated lizard, but I don't have a very good picture of one here. In fact, I don't have a picture of one at all. It just doesn't look like a juvenile to me. Why doesn't it look like a juvenile? Well, I couldn't really tell you, to be honest. He looks wizened. You see his ears there? So anybody who has a better idea of whether this is a giant plated lizard or rough-scaled, let me know. Very cool. Now, he will live there on the termite mound. He'll eat termites, actually. And termites, of course, have been emerging in great clouds recently as a result of the rain. The sort of royal emergences have been happening. And hopefully we'll see one of those tonight. I just think it's one of the most wonderful things to see. And this chap is just breathing very quietly, sunning himself on this glorious Saturday afternoon. He's having a wonderful time. Hello, Melinda. You say this is your very first lizard. Well, I'm glad it was this one because he's a pretty impressive lizard, I think. The other lizards that you might see here, well, the most obvious ones on Game Drive, of course, would be the monitor lizards, the water monitor or the rock or tree monitor. I think that's wonderful. Very, very nice spot indeed. Now, the thing with lizards is that they're great to see, but of course, once they've found a spot in the sun and they don't think that you're going to see them, they tend to, well, sit a great deal. And breathe. He's breathing. You see that, Brian? I'm going to let go of the brake, everyone, so just going to shake slightly. There we are. He's about, you know what, you can't actually see his size. So, Anne, you reckon a rough-scaled plated lizard. Yeah, I agree with you, Anne. I think that is exactly what it is. And it's about probably just over a foot long. From the tip of its little nose there to the end of its black tail. He's a delightful fellow. Gorgeous. Alrighty. Let's carry on from here. Oh no, hang on, we've got a couple of questions about him. Hello, red dog. You're wondering if this lizard has got teeth, since it eats termites. It does have little teeth. They're not particularly terrifying, but it does have teeth. It doesn't only eat lizards, at least termites. I think you'll probably find that it eats lots and lots of different kinds of invertebrates. I'll just quickly have a look again. So it'll probably eat grasshoppers and basically any kind of invertebrate that it's able to catch. But he really is a rather magnificent fellow. Now, what do the books say they eat? Yeah, insects, grasshoppers. That's what they're going to go for. I can't believe I got that right. Quite impressed with myself, Brian. Lots of tail there. Righty, that was the rough-scaled plated lizard. Wonderful. On a Saturday afternoon. Here in the Kruger National Park, South Africa. Right, on we go. We'll see if we can get into that lion sighting now with the Nkuhumas. I notice that nobody has answered my truth and lie question yet.
Sorry, James.
Ah. Right. 5% said fact number one, which was that humans can get mange. 89% said fact two, which was that it is caused by the virus, the chickenpox virus. And 6% said fact three, which was, of course, what was fact three, Brian? Fact three of mange.
You only get it once.
You only get it once, right. So I'm afraid the majority obviously wins there, 89%. It is not caused by the chickenpox virus, it is caused by a mite. And the human equivalent, of course, as we know, is called scabies. And you can actually only get it once. Thank you everybody for playing along, for doing our little test with us. I'm not sure how many people 5% was. I managed to work out the difference between 5 and 6%. It tells me that about 100 people answered, but I'm not sure that that's the case. Madison, I think you were the first to come up with the incorrect fact. You did a poll on Twitter. Excellent stuff. Well done, Kirsten. Kirsten, not only the finest weather predictor in the Lowveld, also very adept on Twitter. She predicted rain today. Do you see any rain, Brian?
No.
It looks quite blue up there, really, doesn't it?
Quite nice.
Yes. There we go. Okay. Kirsten doesn't want to watch us anymore. Let's head across to Steph and get an update from him.
We were just spending some time with this fantastic marula tree, and when I came around the side, something white caught my eye. But it wasn't the only thing that caught my eye, but come with me down here, down while we have a look at this tree. This tree has obviously had an injury to it at some point, and it's allowed fungus and borer beetles to cavitate the inside of this particular tree, and what it's doing is it's providing a hunting ground for a variety of different organisms. But probably the most exciting one for me to see here is at the end of this little stick that I'm going to be showing. I'm going to be using this little stick as a pointer. You just follow my little stick into there and see if you can see what we're seeing right there. Have a look at that. Camouflaging itself down to swaying in the breeze. That is a crested locust. It's still the juvenile, I think. I'm not too sure. You know, we've been seeing so many different species of crested locust lately that I really wouldn't be able to tell you whether or not this was full grown. What I can tell you is that it's probably female because of the lack of wings. The crested locust females have no wings. The males are the ones with the wings and fly around. But just have a look at the exquisite detail.
on this particular locust. There's the head and the little antennae. There are two of them there. And then this ridge, that's where it gets its name, crested locust, from. And then the legs, the jumping legs, are folded tightly against the body there. Just have a look at that. That little wobble there, designed purely and simply for camouflage. What I mean by camouflage, let me show you here. Let me put this crested locust a little bit into the sun with some background. I don't want to scare them. But just have a look at that. Absolutely almost invisible if you didn't know what to look for. Now, camouflage does two things. It keeps the insect safe at nighttime when it needs to rest, but it also keeps the insect safe during the daytime when it needs to feed. That crested locust mouth is positioned on the bottom of its body, so when its head is down and it has this very elaborate camouflaged headdress, it can then hide while it's busy eating without moving. Because movement seems to trigger strikes with insect predators, and birds for that matter of fact as well. They wait for an insect to move and then they lock onto it, and that's when they get snatched up. So the better you blend into your environment, and the less movement you make while feeding, means that you just stand a better chance. And that's exactly the strategy that the crested locust is using. Now, another interesting thing is the fact that there's all these eggshells underneath here. Now, it's not the whole egg, it's just the eggshell, as you can see. I don't really know what bird it's from, other than that it's got this beautiful sort of greenish tinge to it, and it was quite a large egg. I would imagine that it's a whole nesting egg, and that nest would be located somewhere up there. The wind is starting to howl at the moment. Awesome. I love these sort of high energy afternoons that come out of nowhere. Initially, I thought that this egg had been kicked out of the nest by a cuckoo. A lot of the drives that we're having at the moment, we're focusing on cuckoos because they're quite interesting and they just come back. Now, cuckoos are brood parasites, as I'm sure you've heard my colleagues talk about. And brood parasites will come and kick out a host's egg and then replace it with one of their own. But because I cannot find anything except for those fragments, I'm going to change my initial guess at this being a cuckoo who excavated this, and just change it to general predation. I think that this was preyed upon, probably by a monitor lizard, or maybe even by a gymnogene, and the discarded remnants of that feeding that they had fell to the bottom of here. Where the actual nest is probably in that cavity there. But imagine if we walked around this side of the tree, that we may even see, yes, a hole. So now I'm even more convinced that inside that hole was a nest of a bird. A predator went in there and collected an egg, then came out of the nest and probably onto one of those blackened branches at the top there, and then fed on it, discarding the remnants of the egg on that side of the tree where we managed to find them. Isn't that lovely? Got a beautiful, like, silvery sheen now that I see on the inside there. No? Mother of pearl silvery, but definitely a lovely, almost purplish color. Or is that just my eyesight going haywire?
I don't see it.
Dave doesn't see it.
Probably just my imagination.
Alright, let's see what other magical thing we can see underneath this tree before I embarrass myself any further.
Now, marulas, I quite enjoy marulas because they've got a bark that sort of peels off in these little chunks, like this.
That's a marula's bark coming off in these sort of roundish shaped chunks. So the new bark is underneath these areas. The old bark gets pushed off and takes with it any fungus and mistletoe and any parasites that may have embedded themselves into the bark. And that way the tree sort of rejuvenates itself and sloughs off any parasites. We do the same thing with our skins. Snakes do the same things when they get a little bit, when they change skins. They change skins for other reasons, of course. But it's the same thing. Any parasites usually slough off with the skin. But it does allow us the chance to every now and again find something that's quite interesting. Now, I don't normally peel off a lot of bark. I'll normally come to a tree, select one that looks nice, and then just peel back a tiny layer, looking inside there and seeing if you can see anything. I try not to dislodge the bark. It sometimes does come off. But what I'm looking for are pseudoscorpions. I'm looking for spiders. I'm looking for even some small snakes. You get some thread snakes that you sometimes find in the bark of these trees. And now these cavities, even though they don't look like much, these cavities provide such a wealth of hiding places for insects. You almost always find something on here. It might be a bit early in the year. Anyway, nothing here. Amazing. Now, Jackie J, you've just passed a comment along that says you're so astonished by how we always manage to find these small things and you sort of, from what I can catch from Kirsty there, said that we're sort of masters of all here. Thanks for the compliment there, Jackie J. I must be honest with you that most of the times I think I don't really know what we're talking about. There's so much to learn out here. It's just absolutely crazy. This is interesting to see. This is a num num bush, one of my favorite bushes out here. I identified it because of this Y-shaped thorn that it has. And it's on the edge of a drainage line, relatively bushy, has a little bit of a milky latex. And I am going to be keeping my eye open on this tree now for the next couple of weeks. What it's going to do is it's going to get a berry, a red berry. And when you break it open, that berry has a milky latex that comes out of it, very similar to a fig. But unlike other plants out here with the milky latex, which you don't want to eat, this particular plant you can eat with, or this particular berry from this plant you can eat with great relish. It is one of the absolute treats in early summer here, is the fruit of a num num bush, which is what we're looking at over here. Now, while I've been standing here, out there in the trees is a violet-backed starling, and I think what we're going to do is cross over here and see if we can go find him. Let's see if we can cross through here and go find ourselves one of my favorite birds. Okay, I think I see him. So take off the old trusty binoculars. We're on the slight wrong side of the tree here. Come with me, please. I'll try to do it as quick as we can, probably another minute or two. Watch out for Ariel there. Keeping my eyes peeled to the skies. That's just Dave getting a little bit stuck. Oh, look. Our trip has been... Just walk forward. Walk forward. Walk forward, Dave. Walk forward. There we go. We just hold up on all these branches over here. Come look through here. The gap here is not a... That bird that you're seeing over there is doing a dance. Chittering. That is the greater honey guard. Now, not quite the violet-backed starling that I wanted to show you, but equally as impressive. These birds have been calling to humans and honey badgers for centuries. In actual fact, to the point where people believe that there's actually a bond between these birds and people. And that chittering that is so attention-grabbing is designed solely to get your attention, and it absolutely caught my attention. As soon as this bird flew into this area and started making this noise,
my attention was diverted. The story goes that if you follow this honey guide, it'll wait until it knows it's got your attention. Then what it'll do is it'll move from branch to branch, tree to tree, and lead you to a bee's nest, where, because of our love for honey, we'd excavate the bee's nest. Let's see if it comes back. Now that hornbill has just chased it off. Because of our love for honey, we excavate the honey, and in so doing, leave bits and pieces of the honeycomb and the larvae of the bees lying on the outside of the bee's nest. And then that's what that bird eats, beeswax and the larvae, the little bee larvae. Isn't that just amazing? Let's see if we go into the open a little bit over here. Hang on, wait. This way. Oh, look at this, what I almost put my hand on. You've got to be so careful out here. That there would have left me with a big swollen arm for a long time. Summer's here, my favorite. At least that one's not thrashing itself around trying to embed its hairs in me, hey? All right. Let's go over here and see if that bird comes out. I think it may have gotten a bit disillusioned. We might have taken a little bit of time. What we're going to do is we'll stand here in the open and wait for that honey guide to come back, the greater honey guide for you of keeping those bird lists out there. And if it does, we'll see if we can follow it and find the bees hive. In the meantime, I hear Taylor is at a Bivelzoek Dam wanting to show you what's there.
We indeed are at Bivelzoek Dam. Bivelzoek ham. VM, what is wrong with my English today? Because I didn't know there was a type of ham called Bivelzoek ham. VM says he'd like to try Bivelzoek ham. I'm so sorry. I'm going to blame it on the sunblock that I've got into my eyes. Kirsty says it's a smoky ham. She's obviously had it before. But I don't have some ham for you. I've got Egyptian geese and some buffalo that we're going to have a look at. Isn't that just a lovely scene? With the golden light just glowing down on these wonderful creatures. And I must say, I'm growing quite fond of this pair of Egyptian geese that hang around here. This looks like the male. And well, the only real difference between the two is their size. You can just see how much smaller this one is on the left. But their coloration is very similar. And I wonder where their nest is. I know Brent was saying something about it being down in the drainage line, but that'd be an interesting one to have a look. I believe it's in a knob thorn. Make a very, very messy stick nest. Sometimes they'll even utilize nests that have been abandoned instead of creating their own. You can be a bit sneaky and lazy. And I have indeed found an Egyptian goose nest once constructed on top of a termite mound, which was quite amazing. But that was quite a few years ago. And that was on a golf course. And it's something that I often mention about the Egyptian geese is that they're fond of golf courses. I don't know, they must have a very good handicap if they hang around the golf courses all the time. But for now, just filter feeding, seeing if they can find anything. Oh, hello, Mike. We'll just turn Mike's voice down very quickly. And of course, it's still very grim and sad for the buffalo. As you can see, not moving around too much. Now, Zoe, you've shown some concern this afternoon about the buffalo carcasses that are around. And I think it's a good thing. And you're also wondering if there's going to be any disease brought about. Now, not necessarily. Just because there's so many scavengers around at the moment, and even the predators will feed on them too. They don't just have to be vultures and hyenas. So the jackals are coming through, munching away. The vultures are probably having a field day. And we've actually got a vulture sitting up on top of that dead knob thorn. And I wonder if they perhaps haven't been feeding on that buffalo carcass, which died in Bivelzoek Dam, but was then removed. We'll go and have a look in a minute. But this is a white-backed vulture. And I think there's just enough of them around to actually clean up. And the flies are doing a great job at the moment. They're laying lots and lots of eggs, and the maggots are completely decimating carcasses, which is wonderful as well. So speaking of carcasses, let's go and have a look. Those buffalo look very, very sad, and I suspect that they were just really sitting there, just trying to not use as much energy as possible. So sitting in the water trying to stay cool is probably a good idea. But let's go around the corner. Let's have a sneaky look from here. As I can you see it over there, Viam, the carcass? Just on down the road. Oh, very nice. I believe Steph has finally found that honey guy. Let's go take a look.
Actually, the honey guard came back and fetched us, to be quite honest. That honey guard that you're looking at in the tree there has just come from the south. Well, it was chased away by that hornbill first, and then it flew away and has now come back to fetch us. And I think what we're going to do is follow it. For those of you just joining the bushwalk, a few minutes ago we came up out of a drainage line looking for a different bird, and this bird all of a sudden grabbed our attention. This is a greater honey guard and has widely been known for thousands of years to have a relationship with people and honey badgers to show them where beehives are. Obviously, we get to get the honey and the bird gets the leftover honeycombs and bee larvae. So what I want to do is just make sure that this bird knows that we're here, and by doing that I walk straight at it. Now there he goes, and in an exposed spot again at the top of the tree there. So it doesn't want to hide from us. Exposed spot at the top of the tree. So what we're going to do is make sure that he knows we're there. Let's follow him again. Now obviously there's a folklore story that goes with this as well, and part of it is if this bird shows me where the beehive is and I don't open the beehive or I don't leave him any honey, the next time he finds a beehive, instead of leading me to the beehive, he'll lead me to an angry leopard or an angry snake. That's as the folklore goes. So I'm just going to show it. There he goes. He's flown off south. He did see me. Okay. Let's carry on going. I might just get a bit, as we're walking, a little bit faster. Now, of course, the danger here is that while I'm looking at a bird in a tree, I'm not looking for the buffalo on the ground. So just keeping my eyes open here. Okay, I can hear him there. Yes, little guy, we can hear you. There he's sitting. I'm going to show you now. Once again, on an exposed stump. I'll try and silhouette him against the sky for you so that you can see him. Oh, he's flown away, but there he is in that tree over there. So, this closest silver cluster leaf, yep, to us here. Got him?
Yeah, up top, I don't see him.
He's just on the dead branch. When, if we go down here, he'll actually almost be silhouetted against the sky on the tree line. Let's go closer. Don't worry, we'll get you a bit closer. Come on. Yes, we can see you, little guy. There we go. All right, come here, Dave. You can see him now. Now, there he goes over there. Come down a little bit, you'll see him silhouetted. Now, you will notice that there's a slight blur on the lens that we have here. It is a problem that we know about. It's a little bit of condensation on the inside of the camera, making it a little bit blurry at the moment. So please just excuse us for that. It's something that we just saw, and we will get it rectified over the next, who knows, when we get the camera in for a service. But let's show. Alrighty, we're going to carry on with our, let's just show him we can see you. We're going to carry on letting this honey guard lead us to wherever he's leading us. How exciting. And we're going to send you over to James, who's just found a water buck.
That is very cool, everybody, to find a honey guide and to follow it. It could either lead you to step on a leopard or something like that. I've certainly had that experience with them before. Or honey, either of which will be very exciting. Now, we are looking at waterbuck, and the most interesting thing about these waterbuck is something that I've only just figured out for myself, and I've told you 4,500 times, but I'm going to tell you again. They are eating in the ecotone. Now, the ecotone, for those of you who are wondering, is the sort of gap between two different kinds of vegetation. And what we have here is a seep line leading onto a broad-leafed crest. And we know that because that tree that Brian's showing you is a Combretum tree, and the one to the left of it, the tall one to the left, is a silver cluster leaf. Now, silver cluster leaves grow in little groves on seep lines where a very specific suite of grasses grow, and that, in this part of the world, is where we find waterbuck. Not next to where, Brian?
Water.
Exactly. Very seldom do we find them next to water. And I think they're called waterbuck possibly because they do sometimes run into water if they can, if they're being attacked. But you know, they're no real kind of specialist waterbuck hunters out here, so yeah, I guess maybe that need has been negated. But those chaps certainly are nowhere near water, and they're feeding along the seep line and enjoying the suite of grasses that grow there. Now, I must just tell you, we have a small problem, everybody. The right back wheel is about to fall off. It is minus a bolt somehow, which I failed to notice on my pre-drive checks. And so we're just going to nip around the corner to home and put a bolt on so that we don't end up sort of listing to starboard quite severely. No one likes to list to starboard, do they, Brian?
No.
Right, Taylor is with some scavengers of the sky, so let's go and find out if they've seen anything to scavenge.
There are plenty of vultures around, like we saw earlier, and well, very kindly, this one white-backed vulture has decided it's just going to sit and wait for us to come back and say hello. But isn't it nice to also see the blue sky? Now, as you can see, it's got a very full crop at the moment, and I suspect that it has been feeding on that buffalo carcass. Now, we had a quick look at it, and I couldn't see any obvious points where the vultures had been feeding, but there are a number of vultures around at the moment. Look at those talons. How incredibly long they are. And look at, can we go into all those beautiful fluffy feathers that you can see around its legs? Can you see that? It almost is like it's wearing like a sweatband of fluff around its legs. Now, something incredibly important about the vultures is that with them reaching 33,000 feet, you know, they can go quite high up into the sky, you need to try and stay nice and warm. And here you can clearly see the down feathers that these birds have. And now underneath all those other feathers will be that same fluff, and that acts as a really, really great insulation. Now I'm impressed that this vulture is actually able to hang on, because now the wind is really gusting quite hard. Even the hornbill that was also sitting up on this tree has decided that that's too windy for it and has flown away. Isn't that just a beautiful screen capture? I'd have that as my desktop sort of wallpaper. I think that that's quite beautiful, that shot over there. Now remember, if you'd like to send us your screenshots, we're always happy to see them. So you can attach the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. We'd love to have a little look at them a bit later. But you don't look like you're going anywhere. I suspect you will probably even roost here tonight if you've got such a full crop. And I believe, Jamie told me today, that it takes a vulture 30 hours to digest its food. I think that's quite incredible. I didn't know that fact. So you should be good to go for a while then, my friend. But let's go across. Let's quickly go and see these other vultures. I want to have a further inspection of this carcass. Now, as you all know, not fond of the smell of a rotting carcass. And I think that if you enjoy the smell of a rotting carcass, there's something probably quite wrong with you. Now, Sabrina, who's age 13. Hi, Sabrina. You want to know if other buffalo will investigate the carcasses of buffalo. They may walk up to have a look. But I don't think that they would hang around for very long. Now, I'm hoping the wind is going to be in our favor today. But here's another view. Here's two beautiful white-backed vultures. And now we've got the light at an even better angle. Isn't that lovely? And you can see that they've got very dirty heads. Can you see that now? Look at the, I presume that that is actually feces that this vulture has all stuck on its feathers, but you can see a couple of the white feathers sticking out at the back of its neck. And the reason why those feathers are covered in feces, and well, this explains where the vultures have been feeding from. It means as though they haven't actually opened up the carcass, but they've gone in from the backside of the buffalo, and that's why they have these long necks, is that so they're able to stick them in through various crevices and reach for the flesh inside a carcass. And what would have been really nice is, seen as though we're so close to Buffalshoek Dam, is actually to see vultures bathing. Now, I've only seen that a couple of times, but after eating the rancid food that they seem to enjoy most, it's not uncommon for them to go and have a bath. Now, that's wonderful for the vultures. It obviously makes them nice and clean. But unfortunately, what it can do is that it can actually pollute the water sources, because remember, they're feeding on rotten carcasses. That thing's been there for ages now. And sorry, I'm just looking to the sun. I'm just going to put my hand up like that, hide it away from you. And okay, no, I'll just have to close my eyes. There you go. They are. That's amazing. VM's helping me out. Thank you, VM. You're so kind. And I know, if it's, especially if it's a small water source, often they can pass on various diseases. Now, vultures, this is quite interesting, are able to raise their temperatures higher than any other animal, and that's why they're not sort of susceptible to certain diseases. For instance, like anthrax, they're able to beat that, which I find quite amazing. Let's go see if we can get a bit closer to this carcass. We'll try, but if it gets a bit too stinky, I think, well, I'm going to save myself the embarrassment of gagging, and we'll probably move away from it. Hi, vultures, don't mind us. You all look so full. I'm glad you enjoyed that rotten buffalo. There's more vultures. There's actually a whole lot of them. Let's see. Please don't be downwind. You can see. I'm just going to go over this little bump. It's actually not too bad here. And you can see exactly where they've been feeding. So obviously you can see the feces, the uric acid on the buffalo from when they were sitting on top of it. But that is the perfect little circle, little hole for the vultures to poke their heads in and feed on the inside of that buffalo. But it looks as though it's melting away. A couple of flies, thousands of maggots, as you can see, all around there feeding on the buffalo. Oh, that looks terrible. And I think that they were almost be quite disgusting. I think if I had to touch it, it would probably break away in my hand. Now, Liz, you've commented about all these maggots that are on this buffalo and what we've been seeing, and you're wondering if that will then increase the fly population, which will then obviously feed the birds, and you're quite correct in saying that. And I saw a little Franklin running around here now. And I suspect that this Franklin seems to be camera shy, but I think it was probably feeding on the maggots. A very tasty meal. And it's, there we go, there it is. There's a crested Franklin. Now I can smell the carcass too. Now, and it's not the first time we've seen something like this. We've seen it quite often, where the crested Franklins will sneak through in a sighting and pick at the maggots on a carcass that the lions would have been feeding on. Isn't that smell delicious, Viam? Isn't that wonderful? Let's keep going very quickly. We've got to get out of here, I'm afraid. It's not nice. I'm holding my breath. I need to get out of here. Sorry, go away, bird. Oh, it's still very stinky. And of course, we'll bear it because it's not often that we get to see a go away bird up and close. What are you eating? Termites? Let's see what this go away bird is feeding on. Hello, you're very curious. This is so close, this is only a couple of feet from my vehicle. Look at those funny looking toes. Now, it's flown right down onto the ground and it's after something. Now, we normally see them feeding on fruit from the guari trees, of course, to the, let's go forward. I think they're gonna be quite relaxed. Oh no, there's a nice view. You can actually hear it calling. So like I was saying, they feed on the fruit. They love fruit. But I wouldn't say no to a termite if one popped around, and I think that's what was on the ground. And there's a couple of them around here. There's another one just on the right that's being blown off the tree. It's actually quite funny, the one just over there, Vim. Can you see it to the right? No, on the other side of the road.
Oh, that's...
There, yeah, this one over there. Meow, look here. That one is doing handstands, desperately trying to grip onto this branch now that the wind has calmed down. But let's see if it happens again. It almost did a full rotation. It was actually quite funny to watch. Come on, big gust of breeze come through. And that's what happens when you have a long tail and as broad as the tail of a go-away bird. As soon as the wind gets underneath it, it could almost flip you right over if you're not prepared for it. Come on, please do it again, wind. Or go-away bird, have you learned how to hold on now? But isn't this lovely? And a very common bird as well, just to see around in Johannesburg in the gardens. A lot of people like to feed them. Like I said, if you take an apple and you perhaps put a nail in the tree and you stick an apple through the tree, well, that will attract not just these beautiful birds, but of course the crested barbets, also very common in the garden. Oh, now I'm sad that this bird unfortunately didn't do a cartwheel for us. That was quite entertaining, but maybe we'll see something else doing a cartwheel because of the wind. But I'm going to keep searching for anything out here, anything interesting this afternoon. And I believe Steph, let's go see what Steph's actually got for you.
Now, we are actually still with this greater honey guard. Can you believe it? We've probably covered about a mile or so since you were last with us. And this honey guard keeps on just taking us further and further south. Now, as we get further south, Herbert gets more and more skeptical. He says this bird's got a different agenda. The last time he was following one of these birds, it led him to an angry leopard, and he got chased around by this leopard. So he's viewing this honey guard with a lot of skepticism. He's hanging way at the back, looking under every bush, thinking I'm a bit crazy for just running after this bird. But I just want to keep in, I want to keep with it and see what it's doing. There it is there. It says, just come back to fetch us. So you just follow the arc of the branch all the way to the left.
Yep.
And he's...
Just have a look on the screen. Here.
Now, Aaron, you've just said... You've just asked me, is there a difference between a greater and a lesser honey guard? There absolutely is, Aaron. The lesser honey guard is a bit smaller and has a different call. But essentially, they are, and they also have a slightly different distribution area. But Aaron, essentially, they do the same thing. They have this, they have a call that is basically pitched at us and at the way that we listen to sounds out here. It's something that's very recognizable. And between humans and honey badgers, we try and keep this bird full. Now, it of course can hunt for its own food. It's not completely needing a human or a honey badger, but it just makes it so much easier for this bird if we had to do it. Now, it's flown on from here, of course, but I think this bird's going to come back. Let's carry on going down here, see where this bird leads us. Oh, look. Oh, there was a... another plated lizard, but it's disappeared into its termite burrow. I hear James was showing you a rough-scaled plated lizard, and this was exactly the same. Here it comes again. Yeah, here it's going to land on this dead tree, I think. No? Yes? I'm hearing it chittering. That bird that you're seeing at the top there, that's a magpie shrike. There he goes. There's the honey guard, just landed next to it on the left-hand side. There he is, that's the greater honey guard, chittering at us. So let's follow him. Let's just make sure he knows that we are coming, we're coming. I can't wait to see what's at the end of this honey guard's trail. To be honest with you, it could lead us into the middle of the Kruger going for a couple of days. You know how birds go. There he flies off there. Let's just keep an eye on where he's going. Okay, he's going into this thicket. Now, of course, this is just sort of playing into Herbert's doomsday prophecy that I'm going to walk myself into an angry leopard or a lion.
We are going to walk into this thicket over here, and I don't really want to do that without being a little bit more careful. So we're going to send you over to James and his lion quickly, and we'll keep you updated about what's inside here.
Now, this kind of a sighting, everybody, is called a drive-by. And what we're going to do is just go through quarantine clearings, because there's this vast herd of impala, and they're all rather pretty, and the light is soft and gorgeous, and you'll see them running. And I just think it's a really nice wide shot to show you. And we're also, of course, scanning this whole herd for little baby impalas. There are some other impalas. Sorry, I saw in front there, and of course it's very difficult to keep up with what Brian's doing. Then we should there soon pass some nyalas as well. Isn't that gorgeous? There are the nyalas. There's one young nyala bull. There he is. I'm a great fan of the drive-by, I must say. Now, what are you doing, young fellow? He looks very surprised. Hello? Why are you lying down? Are you ruminating on something? Some new grass? Or are you just thinking about life, ruminating on the inevitability of it all? Thanks, Andrew. I'll make my way. Confirm Twin Dam's best route. I'm just trying to get us into the lion sighting, everybody. He's probably ruminating on the possibility of being eaten by the Nkuhuma pride, but the unlikelihood, given that they seem to like to only eat buffalo. Copy, thanks. Beautiful. Let's continue our drive-by. Now, shall we go all the way around? No, let's go through the middle. Let's go through the middle here. And now you might, everybody, you might see some strange footprints as we go past here. Those would be the footprints of the Ladies Running Club that was out in full force today. It is led by Taylor McCurry. You can ask her about that when you see her next. It is joined by Rebecca Christensen and by Geraldine the Cheesecake Kent, who has yet to make her promised cheesecake since her return from leave. Anyway, they were thundering up and down this road, making me look very, very unenthusiastic in my exercises today. So there we are. This is where they began. And we might be able to see their tracks. Well, we can. See that, Brian? See, there their tracks are there. Here we are. That's Rebecca and Jerry running up and down this road today. Sorry, we're nearly at the lions, everybody. My idiocy will end as soon as we get there. I was running on the flat bit over there. I wasn't brave enough to run up and down the slight slope. I don't leave footprints there, of course. No, I float when I run.
So you don't actually run?
I just float. I don't run. And there's a stony silence from the final control. That's never a good thing, everybody. It normally means that there's been a fence caused. It's such a wonderfully beautiful evening. Temperature is perfect. There's a smell of the first wood fires starting up at the camp. Ugh. There's quite a strong northwester, which is slightly a harbinger of a storm. Ooh, termite mound being attacked by hornbills. Now, the lions are just down here, and apparently they killed another buffalo sometime during the middle of the day. Now, we didn't hear it being killed, but we'll go in there and see, have a look. Apparently, it's quite difficult to get in there as well, but if there's any vehicle that can get in, it's one of our little Wild Earth cars. Their one redeeming feature, of course, is the fact that they can get into places that nobody else can. Difficult to think of any other redeeming features, but anyway. Now we're going to look here. While we try and get in here, let's head across to Taylor and get an update from her. Well, and then hopefully you'll have some lions when you join us next.
Now, it may look like this Steenbok is frozen, the way that it is standing. It's a female, and she spotted us, but I wonder if she knows if we can see her, because at the moment she's practicing one of the most basic anti-predatory techniques, which is to freeze. You can see she's listening to me, she's listening to behind her. But something that I want to point out is, look how large her hindquarters are compared to the rest of her body. Can you see that? Abnormally big. And it's something that I've really just noticed by looking at her. Now, it could be the way that she's standing, or the fact that, of course, they need very powerful back legs in order to try and boost them forward to allow them to leap and bound and turn quite quickly. That's incredible, because for their small size, they really are quick. And I always say this, if you had to put a Steenbok and an Impala in a race, in a barrel race, the Steenbok would win every single time. And it's just that they're a lot more agile and are able to turn sharp corners and race around shrubs, whereas an Impala is really built for the open plains and has got an incredible speed to them. And of course can leap massive lengths. But this is lovely that she settled down. And this is also typical, is after the freezing technique, they will often sit down and hope that they're being concealed by the vegetation. And I'm sure well that the Steenbok are appreciating the grass and the leaves, not of course just to feed on, but because now they actually have some vegetation to hide on. I always feel sorry for the Steenbok and the common dacre during the winter months, the yellow season, because they really are quite vulnerable. And down in the south, I definitely noticed a difference when it came to leopards and what they were preying on. And in the dry season, they were taking down lots and lots of Steenbok and common dacre. And then in the summer months, they'd move on to Impala and Bushbuck. Isn't that amazing how they're able to just utilize what they have around them? But Steenbok, that's not a very good place to sit, because you can see as VM zooms away, you can clearly still see her sitting there. But thank you, lovely lady, that was beautiful. We never really get to see those Steenbok sitting down so nicely and so quietly. Oh, VM, can we have a look at the beautiful moon just for a moment? I just want to show you one thing. Isn't this amazing? Look at the beautiful moon, it's almost a full moon. I reckon probably in another day or two, somewhere around there, we should have a beautiful full moon. And I love the way that there's this beautiful big cloud just below it as well. It's almost, I can't remember that game. VM, do you remember that game that you'd have two boards on either side and you'd bounce the ball and you had to stop it from hitting the wall? Don't you remember playing that game? I don't know what it was called, but that's what that reminds me of. But I believe that Steph is still sitting with that honey guide. Let's see if he's found that sweet, delicious treat yet.
I actually think we have found something. I'm not quite sure what. This honey guide is leading us now in a circle. So keeps on coming back to this tree and then circling out this way and then bringing us back again and circling out and bringing back. I'm sure there's something here in this thicket. I'm positive now that it's not a male lion, but I was a bit skeptical coming in here, I must be honest with you. All right, so here we go. Sorry, our audio was gone for a second and now it's back in. It's just one of these little gremlins that creep in here when we're giving you a live feed like this from the middle of absolutely nowhere. Now, let's see if this honey guard is going to come and fetch us from this tree again. And see, it's been quite an amazing journey. For the last 45 minutes or so, I think, we've been on a journey following a honey guide, a greater honey guide. It's a bird that's got a relationship with people whereby it'll show us where, or hopefully this is how the story goes anyway, it'll show us where a beehive is, and in return for us excavating the bees, it gets larvae, beeswax, and the little bee larvae. Now, we've been led probably about 2 miles, I would say, as the crow flies, from where we first found the sunny god, or where it first found us, I should say, and now we're busy circling this thicket, and I think there's something in here. There must be. He keeps on chittering about here, just around about here, and then when we get there, flies off and comes back again. So I'm not wondering if we haven't got a bee's hive here somewhere that I'm missing. It would be really, really awesome if we got to show you a beehive after following a honey guide. Let's see. Through here. Anywhere here could be a cavity in a tree where honeybees could have their nest. Now he's flitting around at eye level again. Now, Rue, you've asked a nice question, and you're a new viewer. So firstly, Rue, I'd like to say welcome to Safari Live and onto the game drive of your life, I should say. Rue, you've asked, why would the honey guide lead us to a leopard and not just to bees every time? Well, Rue, the folklore around it is that if you don't leave enough honey for the honey guide the first time he leads you to honey, he will lead you to a dangerous animal, or a lion, or a leopard, or a snake, the next time you decide to listen to his call. And why leopard was because the last time Herbert, which is our game scout, that's what you're looking at here, is a three-man team. It's myself, and today we have Dave on the camera, and then Herbert, which I'm going to show you in the background over there. That is Herbie right there.
Hey, Herbie
keeps us safe while we are talking to you and have our final control in our ears and everywhere. We can't really listen to the bush, and walking around here in the Kruger Park where we are is a very dangerous thing to do. So we just have Herbie with us. And Herbie, the last time Herbie was following a honey guide, the honey guide led him to an angry leopard which chased him out of a bush. And he doesn't quite know why. He says to me that he did leave honey the last time I'm tied up in a tree, he's bitten me. Herbie says that he left honey for the guide the first time he followed the honey guide, but obviously he didn't leave enough. Now this honey guide is still calling at us from this thicket. We're not going to be able to get Dave through there, but let's go around one more time. And see if we can find anything here. It's going to take us a bit of time to stick our noses into every tree cavity here, and I'm hoping we find something here for you. But in the meantime, we're going to send you over to James, who's sitting with those lovely Nkuhumas.
Well, I actually wanted to show you my very snazzy new green laces. What do you think, Brian?
Oh, I think they are very snazzy.
They're very snazzy. Now, you'll also notice that they were slightly too long, so I had to chop them in half, and I put some very special luminous green gaffer tape on the one end.
Splendid.
Isn't that very splendid? Now, let me do the reveal. There are the Nkuhuma Pride. They are just the cubs at the moment. Now, I can't see any carcass of anything else in here, but the other lions are in and amongst this thicket. Now, I don't think that they're going to go very far if they have killed something else today. But we'll just sit here for a little bit, and then we'll move around and see if we can't get a slightly better view. There are two other guides in here trying to get a view of these lions, and it's not easy because there's a huge amount of sort of thicket in the way. Now, let us compare, if you will, the main situation. I know I've been going on about it. I feel a bit like a broken record, but I really think it's... Brian, sorry, quickly, to the right, there was a lion in a tree. It was a little cub that's jumped out again. Not that one. That one is dead. Well, not dead, but dead to the world. I really think that these guys have, for some reason, have recovered from the mange. They're not scratching anymore. There's a little bit of biting of fur, but no more than is normal. And yet the Styx lioness, who's had the disease for longer than these chaps have, still hasn't managed to shake it off yet. And that obviously must have a huge, must be a huge reason why this pride of lions has managed to maintain all 8 little cubs and the Styx lost all 8 of theirs. If you're wondering what I'm talking about, perhaps you're a new viewer, we view 2 prides of lions here normally. The Styx pride of 3 lionesses, and they had 8 cubs at one stage. And then this pride, the Inkahumas, of 5 lionesses and 8 cubs. The lionesses are obviously invisible. This beautiful sound of the cicadas starting up. And they are both dominated by the 4 Birmingham males. That was one of them that you just saw there. You saw his underarm, his hairy underarm peeping through the thicket. And the Styx pride cubs, all 8 of them, died of mange. We think that they caught it from one of the Birmingham boys. Then this pride started to show signs. They all started scratching and they started to look a bit ropey. We got a bit worried about them. And now they're absolutely fine. They do look, some of them still have got mangy patches, but the endless scratching seems to have stopped. And the mothers don't seem to have picked it up at all. So clearly there must be either some kind of genetic resistance that this pride has to mange, or they have been so well fed during the course of the disease that their bodies have just been much better able to fight it off. That lion is eating a piece of... what is that? It looks like a very small Combretum. No, it's a tambuti tree. You must be careful of that. That's going to give him a nasty runny tummy. And if you've never seen a lion go to the loo, everybody, you will know that a lion does not need any help with making its bowels move, certainly not in front of us. So there are 3 groups of cubs, of course. If you are a new viewer again, they are ranging from 5.5 months old to 3.5 months old. 3 litters, 5.5 months, round about sort of 4 and a bit. No, I'm wrong, sorry, 5 months to 4 months. It's sort of approaching 5.5 months. That's the oldest, then 2 weeks, and 2 weeks behind those come the others. And they're all starting to look rather the same size now. At one stage it was very, very obvious which the smallest and youngest were, but they grow very quickly. As the old cliche goes, Brian, they grow up so fast. Oh, yeah. Yes. Nostalgia. Ooh, now Steph has a surprise, possibly from his quest with the honey guide.
You're right, I have a surprise for you. I've got goosebumps. For the first time in almost a 20-year career, a honey guide has led us straight to a beehive. Have a look inside that tree. What you're having a look at there is a cavity full of honeybees. Isn't that amazing? Yes, please. How awesome is that? Oh, I've got a smile that is just breaking my face at the moment. Herbie's been jumping up and down in joy. We've been giving each other hugs in the bush like a bunch of teenagers. Now, what do we do with this newfound knowledge? Obviously, I'm not going to go and smoke out those bees and use my knife and hack open the tree and gather some honey and then leave this honey guard some honeycomb. Now the dilemma is, do we now follow one of these again and he leads us then to an angry lion or an angry leopard or a snake in a tree, because he's wasted the last hour and a bit of effort with us, and now all we're going to do is say thank you very much, have a nice day, and we're going to walk away, which is of course what we're going to have to do. But you know, isn't that just the most amazing thing? So for those of you just joining us right now, we identified the call of a greater honey guide. I'm going to actually try and see if I can show him to you. He's at eye level now, sitting a bit closer to us, but I'll do it in a second. Greater honey guide's a bird. These birds have an association with people, and where they lead people to honey nests, to bees' nests, and in return, the people who love honey obviously chop open the bees' nests, and in that let
the honey and the comb and the bees' larvae fall on the floor. And when we've had our fill, people depart and the honey guard comes down and then has its meal of beeswax and bee larvae and honey, of course. And they do that with people, and they do that with honey badgers, where honey badgers get their names from. Honey badgers will also quite often follow this bird and this bird call. Now, a honey badger would have absolutely no problem sticking his face into that hole or into that hive. But for me, that, you know, I wouldn't be able to do that. But for the first time in my entire guarding career, I followed a honey guard, taken the patience to listen to it, walked from tree to tree, realized that we were going around in circles. The call of the honey guard became a little bit more incessant when we got to this tree. And then we just came around this tree, looking with our binoculars, and right there, in the sunlight, we caught the little mote of a bee streaking into the tree. And when we came around the tree, in this cavity is the honey, or the bee's nest. I know all of you are saying we have to give the bird honey. You know what? We're sitting over here with, a bit of a dilemma. We have to give that bird honey. We have to give it a treat. I don't quite know what we're going to do here just yet, because we don't want this bird to lead us to a lion or a leopard or a snake the next time we follow one of these birds. And because now, of course, we've gotten it right once, it means we have to get it right the next 1,000 times we try it, little boys. But let's go on here. I want to see if I can show you this honey guard. We haven't seen it for a bit. He's still sitting in the tree over here, busy calling at us frantically. I'm going to try and get him into a view where we can actually show him to you without the sun disturbing it, because I think he also needs, in actual fact, he's the star of the show. He needs to be celebrated for what he is, the greater honey guard. Where are you sitting, little guy? Okay, he's in this tree. Oh, here he goes. Okay, let's see now. He's just going to come around. Of course, he's now going to take us on another circle. There he is. Come through. All right, we got him in the tree. He's not going to go away. He is sitting in the sun, perfect for us at the moment. Let's see if we can get him through this gap for you. All right. Now, of course, because I want to show you, he's going to fly away. Come this side, Dave. Right, now, he's in this tree, on this branch, basically, go to there. Sorry, I'm just pointing at David's stick up a little bit. There, somewhere there is the honey guard. Somewhere in the middle of your screen. We're trying our best to try and see if I can actually see it in the screen. For us, it's just a massive red branches. Go right, go up a little bit. Somewhere there, come on, little guy, go down a bit. Somewhere in those sticks there. Let's see if we can change the angle a little bit. We're going to show him to you. Don't worry. Without him now flying away and thinking that we missed the honey. Where are you sitting? He's probably in full view of us over here, and I can't really see him at all. This is embarrassing, I must be honest with you. Come this side, let's see if we can just silhouette him against the tree there. And now what's going to happen is he's going to fly out when we get a bit closer. Ah, he was right in front of us. Here we go. Alrighty. There he sits on that cross branch at the top there. See on the left hand side, silhouetted against the sky? Okay, we're going to try and show him to you now. Okay, zoom in, go to the left. Sorry. Right. Okay. In the bottom of your screen, now in the center of your screen. There we go, got him. Oh, sorry about that. There we go, got him. I know that took a little bit long. Sorry, everybody. It is a live show, as you all know, and sometimes these things do take a little bit of time for us to find. That is the greater honey guard, the star of the show, over a 2-mile journey, many stops on the way, he finally showed us his honey, or the beehive, where he'd like to get a bite of honey. And unfortunately, we're going to be leaving him unsatisfied. Much to my dismay, to be quite honest with you. All of you are saying that I should run back to the DRC and grab some honey. With it being quite close to the road, actually, I might actually do that. Go fill up a bowl full of termites for this guy and get some honey. There's a praying mantis that was just running away from us here. Just have a look at the camouflage on that guy. It just looks like one of the sticks that we've got. Just look at that. I mean, you wouldn't be able to see, if he didn't move, you wouldn't be able to see that he was a praying mantis at all. Isn't that incredible? Head on the side, with those extended forearms. They have all the spines on them. He shoots them out, catches insects, and watching me with those big eyes, just to make sure that I don't hurt him. I of course won't. Just have a look at that. Absolutely fantastic. Oh, I don't know what I feel right now. What do I feel? I feel fantastic, to be quite honest with you. Right. We're going to have a quick powwow here and decide what we're going to do to celebrate this honey guide. In the meantime, I'm going to send you over to James and catch up with you later.
Oh, the thing now, you see, once you've got a debt, everybody, you've got to pay that debt. And Steph is now in debt to that honey guide. It happens. That honey guide is going to lead us to a snake. You see? Even that little lion was looking upset. Now, I'm slightly worried about that cub. And if you look showing, I think that's very strange. When the lion's been eating this much, maybe it's just his angle that he's lying. There's one cub there. And off to the right-hand side is the rest of the lines. Apparently my signal is not great. I don't know that we can reposition from here, though. I think this might be the only view that we have. What do you want to do? Straighten the aerial. What do you need, Brian? A stick by my feet? No, but you can have my selfie stick if you want it. You want the wheel spanner? Being very fussy about this kind of sticky ones.
Not a sticky stick to put on the
floor. Anyway, I think we're okay. We've got a view of the lions. Now, I was wrong. They haven't killed. Rickson was saying he thinks they are going to try a little bit later. I tend area of, if you follow,
after a quick powwow, we decided that we weren't going to leave this honey guide without at least some prize, and against my better judgment, I suppose, in terms of normal ways of guiding, I've decided I'm going to see if I can entice some termites to come to the surface, and hopefully this honey guard doesn't take it as an offense that he's now showed me the bee's nest, which is exactly what he wants, and now I'm giving him a sort of second-rate prize with some juicy termites. Here, all the termites are coming. So what I've done is I've just created a bit of a disturbance, and as you can see, the termite soldiers are rushing toward that disturbance, and I'm hoping that this honey guard will actually see this from where he is and will come down here and feast on some termites as a consolation prize. What is quite exciting is that bird is still sitting in the tree over there, but disgusted, has stopped calling absolutely completely. There he sits over there in the middle of the fork. Basically, you can see it silhouetted against the sky there. Dave doesn't see it. Come down. Go in, zoom in, middle of the screen. There the bird is. There you go. There he is over there. Not making a sound, not calling. Highly disgusted. Like I said, I'm going to try my best to try and get some termites for it. So I'll use my skills at getting termites out to try and at least give this bird a little bit of dinner. So what I'm doing is I'm blowing into this termite mound. Most of the predators that prey on termites exhale carbon dioxide, and it's the carbon dioxide plus the scraping noises on these termite mounds that elicits such an aggressive response from the soldier termites in this termite mound. And you can see that right off the bat, they've actually just sent in all their biggest soldiers. Those are exactly the type of food that I would eat if I were out here in the bush. Very, very highly nutritious termites, if you can just get past those jaws. And I'm sure the honey guard wouldn't have a problem considering they had to deal with bee stings. These are but a minor annoyance. Now have a look at this. Now I'm just hoping that that honey guard can see this. See, here we go, we're helping you. Come and have a look over here when we're finished. You have some dinner before you go. Wow, there's a lot of these adult soldiers. These are immature soldiers, these small ones. That is the mature soldier. Now that soldier termite is 5 years old already. Can you believe it? That's how big they get. They live for a couple of years, 5 years. That's how big it is. Have a look at my thumb here in comparison to them, or I suppose my baby finger. I'm going to get too close. They bite like crazy. We're going to send you over. Taylor has got another bird to show you.
We've got a lovely purple roller who is just sitting so stunningly for us. But have a look at what I'm about to reveal to you now. Look at that perfect positioning as that the purple roller sits on this dead knobthorn with the moon rising in the background. To me, that is just absolutely incredible. And we're almost at full moon, like I showed you earlier, but you can see the bottom part of it has still got a bit of filling out to do. So that's why I think we've got another, maybe tomorrow night, but I think we've got another 2 days to go before we're going to see a beautiful full moon. And won't that be spectacular to sit up on quarantine and hope for a cloudless evening and watch it rise? Now, there seems to be a pair of purple rollers around here, so I wonder if they're not nesting somewhere. And we know how these dead knobthorns make for a perfect nesting spot, especially if there's some old holes in there, perhaps an old woodpecker nest or a crested barbet hole. You never know what it could be. And it's nice to see them. And sometimes, or especially when I first started guiding, I always used to get confused between the purple roller and the lilac-breasted roller at a first glance, because that very white supercilium, that eyebrow that they've got, is very similar. But something that used to help me was the fact that the purple roller has got way more white stripes on its belly. And you see that, and underneath its throat, they're much more prominent. Whereas on the lilac-breasted roller, well, of course, they've got that bright lilac-coloured breast, and then those white stripes tend to fade. But isn't this just absolutely incredible out here this afternoon? Now, let's carry on. Let's see what else we can find. I think there's a bateleur up in the tree. Let's see if we can get a view for you. Yeah, it's sitting quite nicely. Now, don't fly unless you want to go and sit on that knobthorn too. You're allowed to go and do that. Look at that. Stunning. And just catching the red skin on its face, that sun is just creeping through this alive knobthorn. And I think that this bateleur eagle is settling in for the evening. It looks as though it's got a good spot up there. Couple of leaves to keep it out of the rain if we do get some rain tonight. And now it's having one last groom. And I really cannot stress to you how important it is for birds to groom themselves. Now you can see it's very carefully running its beak through each individual feather. And if you put a feather under a microscope, you're actually able to see the tiny little barbs, the little hooks that they have on their feathers. And by running their bills, their beaks, through the feathers, they're able to re-hook each hook where it's supposed to go. And if they don't do that, well, then they're going to have a bit of difficulty trying to fly. And we know with the bacheliers, not being the most elegant flyers, they seem to wobble quite a bit with a shorter tail. This, of course, will help them even more. Isn't that lovely? We're on Leadwood Road at the moment, and there's a juvenile that's around here. And I was hoping to hopefully get a glimpse of that juvenile, but it seems as though it doesn't want to hang around as nicely as this adult. Now, I believe, though, James has got a different view of the moon. Let's go across and take a look.
Yes, this is a fascinating view of the moon, isn't it, Brian? It's a gorgeous moon. Obviously, we've got a very special camera at the moment, and this is a tree currently growing on the moon. That's the moonscape. Beautiful. No, it's not, obviously. That is a tree, everybody, that we have found underneath the moon, and it's a nest. But what is interesting, before Brian goes all the way in there, you can see to the left of the cavity, there's a piece of branch that looks like it has probably been snapped off of the place where the cavity was. And I suspect that there that you're looking at now was the entrance to this nest. I suspect that it was probably the nest of an oxpecker, and I suspect also that the elephants came past here and snapped it off. And I think that's probably the cavity in which the little oxpeckers were. The reason I say oxpeckers, you can see there's animal hair in there. And that is sort of normally fairly indicative of oxpeckers. They like to make their nests or line their nests with animal hair, obviously, because they sit on animals. So I think that's probably what that was. There's a very mangled feather, quite a lot of down in there, and it just looks like quite a cozy spot to live. But I think it's probably inactive, and I think probably because it was snapped off by some elephants. Now, we came here not so much to look at the moon, although there is a gorgeous sight of the moon, which Brian will show you. There it is, Brian.
The moon.
The she's. The rabbit. No. The man. All the other things. And we came here to see if we could find the lions again from the other side, because I'm afraid we obviously didn't have any signal. They're in there somewhere. We had a sort of half glimpse of one very comatose cat, and I think we're just going to pull out of here and see if maybe we'll drive past this area again as it gets dark and see if maybe they don't pop out. In the meantime, I think we're going to go towards the western side of the reserve. I was just saying to Brian how I never get north and south confused, but east and west all the time. And we'll see if we can't pick up maybe some leopard tracks. And also there were some elephants just down the road here. So we'll try and see if we can't see them. Meanwhile, the gorgeous afternoon continues, and I am a little suspicious of Steph's solution to his dilemma. Obviously, his dilemma, which I'm sure he's explained to you, is A, that he doesn't want to destroy the bees' hive, largely because he's probably being sensitive about the bees, and then secondarily, of course, because he doesn't wish to be stung to death, which is, of course, a very unpleasant experience for anybody. But you know, it's not called a honey guide for nothing. It's not called a termite guide, is it, Brian?
No.
No, it's called a honey guide because it likes bee larvae. It is not something that has ever led any creature to a termite mound. So I'm a little bit suspicious of whether the honey guide will be satisfied. Now, there's an interesting arrangement just up to the left here. We can see Mrs. Wahlberg's. I think it's Mrs. or Mr. There are two of them there. One of them's in the nest looking at us. And living around here... Oh, sorry, quickly. Taylor's got some baboons running.
This is the first time I've seen such a big troop of baboons since I started working here at Wild Earth. Now, it's a massive family, but unfortunately, they never seem to be too fond of us in the vehicles, and I suspect that that's over the number of years that these creatures have been persecuted by humans. Well, they always seem to run away, so we've parked it at quite a distance. We're at Twin Dams, And we'll just let them move across the area. But there's a few that are still sitting around. It looks like a big male. Now we're going to see lots and lots of males in this troop. Because unlike the zebra and the impala, the males form these super groups, which we call oligarchies. And all of them will protect the troop, as well as do the mating with all the different females. Now let's see if we can find any tiny babies. Doesn't look like it. But I mean, you can clearly see the difference from a male to a female. Obviously, it's much easier when they're adults. When they're younger, well, this is a little bit more tricky, but they're coming back towards us again. And I'm sure that they are going to be enjoying the flush of green. They'll be feeding on all the nice new green grass shoots, as well as the flowers that are about and the odd fruits, perhaps the jackalberries if there are any. There's a little baby. You see it? It's just, there we go. A little bit older though, because it's out on its own and able to climb the trees. Not just dangling off mom's back, which they love to do, which is one of my favorite things to see. And even starting to forage for itself. So that must be at least a month or two old now. I suspect a little bit wobbly, but still able to carry on. Yeah, it's taking its food with them. Here comes some more. Look at the little ones playing with each other. And I always find that these baboons get quite riled up just before the sun goes down. Very much like how we see the lion cubs playing. And I suppose it's their last opportunity to play before they have to go to sleep. And I wonder which tree they're going to roost in this evening. What I'd like to do is I actually want to try and follow them for a little bit and see where they go. Because I've seen a big Balanites tree. Oh, look at this little one has now jumped back up onto mom. Hello. That is incredible when they sit like that. Let's see if we get another view. Here's an opportunity for some screen grabs. That is so funny. I think baboons are much cuter than the vervet monkeys. And I suppose it's also because I haven't had as many bad interactions with the baboons as I have the vervet monkeys. Now, I'll tell you a story about baboons. When I was first studying to be a guide, we used to have lectures and then we'd spend quite a large amount of time out during the day in the bush. And I was just about to leave to go to a lecture. No, sorry, I went to the lecture and I forgot something in my room. So I had to walk back down the pathway. And I had my headphones in listening to some music. Anyway, and by the time I got to my room and look up, I was surrounded by a huge troop of baboons all feeding on the guari trees around my room. And it was crazy. And I thought, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? And I just stood still and I watched them and they didn't seem too bothered by me, which was amazing. But I was a bit nervous of those big males because their canines are larger than the lion's canines. And we're going to try and get another view of them again. Let's go around. We'll jump back across from the main road. And so I just stood there and I watched and there was this massive boulder. And I kid you not, it wasn't even a rock, but it was about that, I can't even show you, like about that big. It was huge. And I thought, okay, this is interesting. And this big male baboon walked over to it and he took one hand, lifted it up, grabbed a scorpion, popped it into his mouth, put the rock down and moved on. Eventually they moved off and away from me. And I thought, well, that rock couldn't have been too heavy. So I tried to move it. I couldn't even make it move slightly. And that's when I truly realized the strength and the capability of these baboons. And if you had to give me the option of facing off a male lion or a baboon, well, look at that, that has lost its fear for humans, every single day I would choose a male lion. I'm petrified of these things. Hello, it's okay, we're going to leave you alone. We're just watching you, having a quick scratch, keeping an eye out on us. And that was so quickly that they moved and disappeared into the vegetation. Now that's something, if you ever come to South Africa, something that you must remember if you do go and visit Cape Town and the various touristy points like Cape Point and Boulders Beach. Perhaps there's some money in the car Please be very careful of them, because unfortunately what's happened is that people have fed them and they've now learned that it's much easier to take food rather than to go out and forage for food like we've seen these baboons doing. And they will rip your handbag right out of your hand. They will break into your car if you've left it unlocked to get inside and take all the food. They are the biggest thieves, but of course they've been taught by us quite sadly. So just be careful of them, because if you try and fight back, it is very, very dangerous, of course. So try not to do that. And if they do take your handbag, it's honestly just worth just give it to them. And well, then it's an excuse to go shopping again. We're going to see what else we can find. I haven't seen any leopard tracks just yet. Still having a little look around. But we're going to have a quick look around here and a scan. And VM has given me strict instruction that tonight he would like to see a leopard. So lots of pressure for him. But while I try and find VM and, well, all of you watching a leopard, let's go back to Steph just before the sun sets.
Marvels. This here that's sitting on my finger. And I've just picked it up to give you an idea of the size of this particular animal. Shame it's hurt its front leg, but that wasn't from me, I promise. That was hurt before we got here. That is a weevil. Can you believe that? You know those things that we find in old cereal? That is just one of the bigger ones. Isn't that amazing? That's a weevil. Now, weevils represent quite a large group of insects, but what is significant about a weevil is that they are probably about the most advanced beetle that we have out here in terms of body structure. This body structure is about as strong as what you can get an insect's body in Mother Nature. Isn't that amazing? It's just engineered to be super, super tough. And we find these weevils coming out and enjoying summer here with us. But don't you just find it amazing that they can get to that size? Let's have a look at how big that weevil is. Very nice. What are we doing? We are making our way back to quarantine. I must be honest, that honeyguard adventure took us probably about 4 miles away from quarantine, and the sun has gone down. There's the west, as you can see, with not a glimmer in it anymore. And what we're trying to do now is march pretty much in a straight line towards quarantine, but this time of the night, what you want to try and do is you don't want to head for thick bush. What we've got to do is head to keep to the open areas, use our knowledge about the terrain, find the most prominent game paths, and then get onto the game paths without getting into any thick bush at this time of the night. You have a lot of leopard, you have a lot of lion that will get going at this time of the night. That's something that we want to try and avoid. So we're going to carry on going. We're going to send you across to James, who I think is with... I'm not too sure. He's got an animal for you there.
That is, I'm not too sure, everybody. Something. Not so, Brian.
Yes, yeah. True.
Mm. Now, this is not the same bird that we were with earlier. Now, I will finish my story unless Taylor bumps into something else exciting while we're here. This is the nest, I thought, of two chocolate-coloured Wahlberg's eagles, and I'm starting to doubt myself. Maybe it's a white one and a chocolate one. There's definitely at least one chocolate one here down on Twin Dams Road. So if anyone can remember if that nest was occupied by a chocolate and a white one or two chocolate ones last year, that would be great to know. Because if it was two chocolate ones, one of them died, obviously, and the other one has, unceremoniously moved on. Anyway, what I was going to say at the last Wahlberg sighting, where Mrs. Wahlberg was that they live in the same tree as lots and lots of red-billed buffalo weavers, and there's probably a bit of an uneasy peace there. A Wahlberg's eagle will eat a buffalo weaver, I'm sure, if it can get hold of it, but largely they'll eat lizards and small mammals if they can get hold of them. But they won't be averse to catching a bird, but obviously they're not very good at catching birds, and so those red-billed buffalo weavers in the other tree were very happy to live next to the Wahlbergs, although they do spend a great deal of time shouting at them. Randy, you're watching on Periscope from the depths of the Southern Ocean. That's just a small, stupid joke. And you say that this bird is beautiful. It is absolutely stunning. Now next to us is another bird started calling. It is a striped Le Valence cuckoo. Let me just ease forward. We'll do a drive-by, Brian. Can you hear it, everyone? Pew, 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 pew. It will be looking for a starling or a bulbul's nest to pillage. To cuckold. No, I can't see it.
I can't either.
I can't see it. Let's go forward and see what else we can see. Oh, there's a bee. There's a bee already. We're being attacked, everybody, because Steph has not done what he's supposed to do. I saw a bee in the car. Hold on, Brian.
Hold in.
I think we're okay. Steph's got bad juju now for us, everybody. Right, we've come to Twin Dams. I'm being totally ridiculous, of course. We came to Twin Dams earlier, and I just wanted to do a little foray down to the south here. We tried to find the elephants again, but we didn't find them. And so now we're going to just do the southern boundary and see if the Great Queen isn't somewhere around. Something else of vital importance I wanted to tell you about cuckoos. Now, again, I've lost my train of thought as we were unceremoniously attacked by that bee. Don't even know if it was a female bee or perhaps it was a harmless drone.
Either way, you can't be too careful.
You cannot be too careful, Brian.
No.
Are you allergic to bees?
Somewhat.
Somewhat? Badly?
Not too badly.
Oh, that's a relief. Now, there's a single guinea fowl over there, Brian. Do you see it? I wonder what it has done to make the rest of its little flock so upset that they don't want to be with it anymore. That is a very lonely guinea fowl, everybody. They're normally in flocks. You can see, very, very agile, very fast, very blue-headed. And that, of course, is the helmeted guinea fowl. Some people will describe as a bush chicken. It is a fairly stringy bush chicken, I'll tell you that for free. But that blue head is just too gorgeous. Isn't that amazing? It's a very sprightly set of wattles that he has there. Those are those floppy bits that make him look a little bit like a turkey. It's called a wattle. And that bizarre kind of calcified protrusion off the top of his skull. It really is very strange to find a guinea fowl on its own. I can't. There are often lots around here, and there's a little pan down to the sort of left-hand side of where that guinea fowl's looking. And often there are guinea fowl there. He also seems to be slightly confused about the thorn bushes that were in the way of stopping him moving down there. He seems to be unaware that he's actually a pretty good flyer as well. He doesn't have to run. He's so cool. I think we should follow him. Let's follow him and see if the rest of his flock is around. See, he didn't want to go down where it was thorny and horrible. He went down this road here. You still got him?
He's on the road, yeah.
He's on the road, the other road. Oh. Hello, Ladybag Van Daisies. It sounds like your name there. You say it looks like he's... Ladybugs and Daisies. I thought it was a sort of German Twitter handle. Ladybird Von Daisy. As you've got in there. Brian's got him, everyone, somewhere. Oh, there he is. Well spotted. You say Ladybird Von Daisies. I'm going to call you that because I quite like it. You say it looks like he's been holding his breath. That's why his face is blue. Not known for their ability to sort of free dive, guinea fowl. Yes, this one is definitely unaware that he is able to fly quite well. If I was looking for my family, I'd be flying. Now, Alice, you're probably asking this question because I keep referring to him as he, but it could be easily be a she. You say, do only the males have blue heads? And the answer is no, they both have blue heads. But what I'm just interested in here is those wattles. Because wattles are interesting in that they're normally only on male birds. But no, they're both sexes alike. It's interesting. So they've both got the wattles. The only bird I can think of like that. Do turkeys both have wattles as we head towards Thanksgiving? Do lady turkeys have wattles? I don't know. Right, excellent sighting of guinea fowl, top class. Right, we're onto the southern boundary now. We're going to turn to the west into the recently set in sun. Setted sun. The sun has set. And we'll see if we're lucky. Fallen, let's see if her spotlight is on and what creatures of the night it is catching.
My spotlight is not on just yet, but some of my other lights are on. And, well, I'm still in search for the chameleon because I have yet to see one this season, so I think I'm due now. And I'm just trying to check also along these drainage lines, having a little look-see to see if there's any leopards around, but so far, nothing just yet. But we won't give up, we will be patient, and we will persist and see if we can find anything. Here's my spotlight, it's in here. Don't come out of there. We've got to fight to get it out of its cupboard. Come out of here. Now it's tangled, but it'll be all right. Let's see, yeah, we could start using a little bit light still, but we'll get there. We know how quickly it gets dark once the sun dips behind the horizon, and I think it's done that by now. And it seems as though we've had a birding afternoon, which has been fantastic. And then we all saw lots and lots of different special birds, as well as having a quick look at the Nkuhumas too. So it hasn't been a bad day. Now, Vim, what do you think is going to pop out this evening? Leopard. Vim's still on about the leopard, and he's not going to let me have a break either. He's been very strict. Hang on, Lex is looking for me. Go, Lex. I'm being summoned. Let's see.
I don't know if you want to check quickly where we're having drinks at Treehouse Dam. Impala giving an alarm course just to the south of Treehouse Dam.
Right. Well, you heard that. No problem. I'm going to zip around. I'll be there now. Thanks, Lex. Right. That's exactly what we're going to do. VM says, told me it was leopard. We don't know what it is just yet, but we're going to go and investigate. That's for sure. Let's just turn around very quickly. And well, you know what this means? It means that I'm not going to be driving like a tortoise. I'm going to be driving a little bit quicker than a tortoise. And now we need to go back the same route. VM, do you remember which way we came? VM says, past the dam. Yes. So I'm going to pick up the pace. I want to go in here exactly where these impala are alarming. Zoom, we go. We came down here, yes, we did. I can follow my tracks. Well, I wouldn't be a very good tracker if I couldn't track my own tire tracks that I left. Okay, now, like I said, I'm going to pick up the pace. Because if they are alarming, they're going to be looking in a specific direction too. So we want to see where that is. And he said that they were alarm calling just south of him, so I presume maybe closer towards Gowrie, Maine. Let's have a look. Over some roots that are growing in the road. Luckily, I don't drive too fast, because then I could have been quite far away, so we should be around there in just a moment. It could be anything, really. I know the Birmingham boys went south, so it could be another one of the Birminghams coming back across. It might not be a leopard. Let me just check. I've got my radio turned up in case Lex gets hold of me. Right. Coming around now. Okay, I'm starting to see some impala. In the thicket, I'm gonna just quickly switch off. Oh, we're gonna have to also wait here because I can see some ladies using luxury bathrooms. So I'll just wait for them to finish. There is one impala, but I don't know if you can see it. It's just moving in the distance. It's just gone behind some trees. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go investigating. But I don't want you to see these lovely ladies who are using the luxury restroom, so we'll let them go in peace. So we're going to very quickly go across to James, who has got some buffalo.
Good grief, nobody wants to see that, everybody, especially not on safari. Anyway, just perish the thought, and I apologise for Taylor for putting that thought in your mind. Okay, on to the buffalo. I'm slightly shocked, I don't know what to say. A very small breeding herd of buffalo consisting of how many animals, Brian?
Two.
Two. A breeding herd of two buffalo. This is very unusual. That is the cow, and then there seems to be one youngish bull there. Very strange. And, I mean, this is not strange in the context of this year, of course. We've seen this again and again. Tiny little breeding herds of buffalo. I mean, calling this a breeding herd is obviously ridiculous. But it's not a bachelor herd. It's... Is that a... It is a bull, isn't it? No, it's not. It's a cow. It's two cows. Definitely a breeding herd, everyone. And this has happened, of course, because the resources are so thinly spaced out at the moment that all the big herds have split. It's made them very difficult to defend, and I think that's one of the reasons that so many have been devoured by the Nkahuma pride. And interestingly, remember we were chatting about this the other day, how the female impala seemed to have got through the drought better than the males. And then my friend Tom got hold of me and said, well, you know, it actually happens with many mammal species around the world. It's almost universal. And certainly the Nkahumas have been taking out quite a few big buffalo bulls, which in theory are much harder to take out than a female. They're substantially larger, almost 1.5 times the size. But this cow, while she doesn't look so fly, definitely doesn't look nearly as bad as some of the bulls we've seen. So maybe it is that the cows are in better condition and the males are just so weakened that they're unable to cope. Oh, that's a lovely shot there. She's hiding behind the tree, Brian.
I can see.
Because I said Nkahuma pride, so she's now hiding behind that mound and the tree. Don't worry, they're not close by. Yes, you can come out. Well done. There you are. Now she's confused. She's stuck behind a tree or underneath one. Yes. She's a young cow. She's probably only about 3 years old. And hopefully she'll have a couple more seasons to produce little cows. Little calves, I mean. Well, this, you say, the smaller the herd, the harder to be found. That is true for small animals. It is not true when you weigh close to 1,000 pounds. Well, in fact, in a buffalo cow's case, almost exactly 1,000 pounds. And Liz, it's actually the reason that many animals do herd. Once they get to this, or any bigger than a sort of bushbuck size, the advantage of being in a herd outweighs the disadvantage of being more obvious because you're in a herd. But smaller than that, you'll find most animals are solitary, except for little mongoose, of course. Yes, that is correct. Hello, Brian, on Periscope. Lovely to hear from you on Periscope. It's so nice to have a new platform that you can enjoy the safaris on. Brian, You've heard, obviously, that buffalo are extremely dangerous to human beings. Brian, I have said this to our sort of, I guess, our older audience. I don't mean that physically, of course. I just mean a more experienced viewership quite often, that no animal out here is inherently dangerous, but a buffalo is more easily threatened than others. And so if you come across a bull and it's in the bushes and you give it a fright and it doesn't think it's got anywhere to run, then it will become quite dangerous. Sorry, I just want to move. I think if I start the car, it's going to move. I'll just quickly move back a little bit so that Brian can get a slightly better view. And Brian, the reputation that they have comes from the fact that they are very dangerous if you're trying to kill them. And hunters have, you know, they've known the buffalo as one of the big five animals to hunt. And if you shoot a buffalo and you wound it, it unsurprisingly gets quite cross. And when it gets cross, it becomes dangerous. But I have walked very close to buffalo bulls, and they haven't looked at me at all. I've said that the bulls looked in better condition. That cow looks in horrendous shape. But definitely, the more stressed they are, the more dangerous buffalo bulls are. The cows, not so much. I mean, Taylor had, you must ask Taylor to tell you the story that she had the other day, an experience she had the other day, Brian, where a buffalo bull, stressed by the drought and the heat, gave her a very nasty fright in the middle of the day. And she's obviously fine. So yes, they are potentially dangerous. They are not inherently dangerous by nature. They're also almost invisible now. You see that, Brian? Mm-hmm. Very nice. Right, let's continue our little southern boundary foray. You will notice there, everybody, that Brian managed to do a 180-degree swing around. He is very flexible, of course, and that, Brian, is because you worked for the
circus.
The circus one day, that is true. Right, let's head back across to Steph. He's going to probably say goodbye to you on quarantine clearings. He's probably looking at the west.
You know, this has to be the largest black monkey thorn that is at Juma. Now, I'm not a big fan of black monkey thorns. I must be honest with you, they scratch the cars and they make a noise and they just sort of are infesting the crests around here. But when you find one of this magnitude, you have to stop and gaze at it in wonder. I must be honest with you. This is a granddaddy of black monkey thorns. They normally only grow to a scraggly bush, no bigger or thicker than this, really. Just very, very nice to see, actually. I wonder if this one is going to fruit. It's been heavily damaged by elephant, I see, over the years, and by termites. I see it's actually hollow on the inside. There's, in fact, a termite mound and everything that is growing sort of up and around this tree. This is how long it's been here. To a point that a baby jackalberry has even decided to germinate next to it. This is a baby jackalberry tree growing next to this black monkey thorn. While I'm here, why I actually came here was because there's a gerbil nest or gerbil warren. I don't quite know what the collective noun is for gerbils, but here we have bushveld gerbils, which is a type of rodent, a type of rat or mouse that is living underneath and in the roots of this old black monkey thorn. I want to show you their colony here. You can see here's an entrance hole here. And there's a little entrance hole there. They have a number of entrance holes to these warrens. And what makes it significant is nothing more. Well, I don't know much more about bushveld gerbils, to be honest with you. But you can, obviously, if you're in a survival situation, eat them. But I don't want to eat these guys. What they do is they aerate the soil. So they dig these tunnels underneath the ground. They bring up all the nutrients that the termites have taken under the ground. They'll bring right up back to the surface again. They'll put a lot of air into the ground, and that sort of helps the ground actually achieve a more climax state, and is probably what led to this black monkey orange, which is a what they call a, I can't even remember my terminology over here at the moment, but when we're talking in terms of plant succession, these guys here come in first and they stabilize the ground, and once the ground is stable, it allows more climax species of trees like this jackalberry to germinate. And that's exactly what's happened over here, with the help, of course, of gerbils and termites and everything else that's just so wonderful out here.
We made it back onto quarantine clearings, and at the moment the visibility is about 200 yards or so. But can't see anything. Nothing much has come out onto quarantine just yet. Now Debbie, all the way from Vancouver, you've asked me, do I ever find owl pellets out here? Debbie, from time to time we do find owl pellets. The easiest place to find an owl pellet is to go and have a look where owls like to roost. And either during the day, so close to a nest or a favorite roosting spot in a dark tree, or where they're hunting at nighttime. So owls are creatures of habit, and they will enjoy a specific branch next to a road that they can use to hunt well on. And quite often underneath these perches you'll find owl pellets. And I'll do my best over the next couple of days to see if we can't find ourselves an owl perch and an owl pellet for you. I don't know if we're going to be successful. Off the top of my head, I don't actually know if I can remember ever seeing an owl perching anywhere here. But we'll definitely keep our eyes open for you nonetheless. All right. Now, the visibility that we have over here is probably around about 200 to 300 yards or so, which is more than enough for us to stay safe where we are at the moment. So we'll be able to do a couple more, maybe one or two more segments from the top of quarantine and maybe find you something else like this grandfather of all black monkey oranges. Let's carry on. Oh, the sky is just absolutely unbelievably beautiful today. Full moon, or near it anyway. Right, we are going to send you over to James while I wander around on quarantine.
I hope fervently that he's not going to wander around quarantine for too long. It is getting very dark, isn't it, Brian?
It is.
Yes. It is time for the creatures of the night to come out. Oh, ghostly creatures of the evening. Now, we would go back to the Nkuhumas, but I'm afraid there is simply no signal where they are in this car, and so I don't think we're going to do that. I think we're going to just keep up the western fringe here and see if we can't pick up the eyes of a leopard. There was a serval living around here at one stage. Maybe it's still here, Brian. Yes, that would be exciting.
Or a chameleon.
What?
A chameleon.
It would be nice. We've only seen one chameleon this season.
No, I've spotted one.
You've spotted one?
Yes.
Oh, well done. I saw the first one though, didn't I?
Well,
yes. No, not debatable at all. Watch out, plover. There was a small crowned lapwing on the road there. Everybody was stunned by the light or by Brian's mustachioed thumb. Now, James, you're a very observant fellow indeed, and you say, what's happened to all the trees that have been pushed over on the roads by the elephants? They have been removed by the road crew. I didn't mean to say crew there.
They have been removed by the road crew. The road crew has pulled them away with tractors.
They've been spending some time on the roads recently. Ah, now Taylor has actually something worth showing you this evening.
Finally, it's been a couple of quiet nights out here. I'm trying to find, where did it go? There it is. That is a little bush baby that we're looking at. And for once, one that is not making too much, well, not jumping around, not making too much noise, jumping around too much. Now, I apologize. I'm trying to watch the screen because this bush baby is quite far away and it's quite difficult to try and keep the spotlight still and on it. And it looks as though it's feeding on something. Can you see that? And I think that's why it is sitting so still and not bouncing around. Maybe it's found some beetles or something that's in that tree. And this is the common one that we see around here, the lesser galago or the lesser bush baby. And they're known for eating insects, but typically they will jump and leap and grab the insects right out of the sky. But I suppose it's easy when they are sitting on the branch. I wonder. It's so far away. It's a pity that we can't really see what it's doing. I don't think it's grooming itself or anything. It's sort of, you can see now how far away it is, of course. This has got its head on the branch. Maybe there's some little boring beetles, or, and when I say boring, I don't mean beetles that aren't fun. Beetles that bore into the wood. Where's it gone now? There it is, just a little bit lower down. Hello, back again. Maybe there's a couple of them around on that tree, and perhaps that's what it's looking for, because it's smelling the whole tree. This is lovely behavior. And especially that it's sitting still. But I suspect with all the termites that we've got around at the moment, they're going to be very excited and we'll be leaping around, catching them. And they're able to do that. They've got these very large fingers. And as they're jumping, it's really incredible to actually watch in slow-mo as they leap into the air and capture their prey. Let's see if it's going to jump to the next branch. Looked like it wanted to. No, still hanging around there. Well, that's all right, I suppose. Having a little scratch. Now, Kathy, you're wondering if a bush baby is a monkey. No, it isn't. But, you know, the only thing that I can think of that it's closely related to is if you have a look at what a pygmy lemur looks like. Unfortunately, I don't have a photo of one of those because they don't occur, well, in South Africa. You seem to find them around Madagascar. And if you look and search for a picture, pygmy lemur, you'll see that the lesser galagos resemble them quite a bit. But if I'm not mistaken, I think they are a species of primate, but something slightly different. Oh, did you see how it heard me? I had my foot resting on the clutch. And as I took my foot off of it, it sort of slipped a bit and made a noise. And from that distance, it turned its head and looked at me. They've also got incredible hearing, and I think when they do capture their prey, they can listen for it. Most of the insects either their wings flap and make a noise, or some of them make buzzing sounds. Oh, there's something flying around. Look up, look up. No, not interested. Must be eating something else that's in the bark. Maybe it's even feeding on the gum or sap that's on this tree. I'm trying to work out what it could be eating. Now, James, you're wondering if a bush baby would ever eat a chameleon. I don't think so. They're insectivores. So they wouldn't really feed on a reptile. But there's an exception to every rule. Maybe it was desperately hungry, it would, but I've never seen it before. But I've learned that you can't not say anything out here. Because nature is so random and just incredible that we always learn something new every time we're out here. I'm just completely fascinated as to what it was feeding on that tree. Well, it seems to... Oh, and then it goes. Now, it's jumped down a couple of branches, and unfortunately, I think that that's the end of that. But wasn't that lovely to have a quick little glimpse at, a bush baby? And I was saying the other night, I hadn't seen them for a while. But let's have a look. Maybe we find some more. Right, let's see what else we've got on the agenda for this evening. Come on, come a chameleon. Do a little dance. Maybe if we sing that song, we'll get a chameleon. But as you can see, I'm not very talented at dancing or singing. It's fine. I can do other things. Can't do everything. Unless you're James Hendry, well then. Then that's a very talented person. He climbs trees, he sings. He makes up songs, and well, I'm just not as great as that, but that's all right. But let's see. I'm just scanning very carefully because I don't want to miss a chameleon, so I'm going to go back to a snail's pace. And we went and had a look, and we did a big loop on Gowrie Cutline in case you were wondering what happened to the alarm calls. But sadly, nothing came of it. I checked for footprints. Couldn't see any footprints at all coming in or leaving. And I bumped into a Simbambili ranger, and he said that Mr. Tingana was on their property lurking around. So perhaps he's doing his rounds and maybe he'll be back. Ooh, an insect in my ear, that wasn't nice. Come on, chameleon. We have to spot one. I mean, if we can spot the bird feces on the tree, if we can spot a moth, we should very much be able to, of course, spot a chameleon. Now, I'm not sure what Kirsty whispered into my ear, but she said something and something and something, and then that we should go to Steph. So let's go to Steph.
All right, we made it back from the bush, and we're now standing safe and sound in the DLC. So thank you very much for all your concerned comments about us, but we're all okay. Don't worry about that. We just had such a fantastic time today. How's that for a 10 out of 10 score with that greater honey guard leading us straight to the beehive? Yes! All right, just for myself and Dave and Herbert today, we just want to say thank you very much for joining us on the bushwalk. You'll definitely see us tomorrow morning again, so tune in. We're going to send you over to James to say goodbye, I think, eventually.
I must say, I'm completely amazed and very happy that Steph got that honey guide thing. I've followed them many times, and I'm afraid I've never found honey with them. I've been led into a leopard once by them. But otherwise, I mean, I know a number of trackers out here who will not follow a honey guide at all, simply because of that, being led into snakes or predators. I think a lot of that has to do with legend, and some of it to do with happening to stumble over a snake or a predator while you're following the honey guide. But isn't it a remarkable piece of evolution? I think it's absolutely astounding. Now, of course, Brian told me that on this road we would almost certainly have a chameleon, didn't you, Brian?
I did.
Yes.
Might have made a mistake.
Yes, you may have.
Maybe not.
I'm very impressed that Taylor was singing Karma Chameleon to you. I'd be very interested to know if it has an effect. What do you think, Brian?
Definitely.
Do you think that Taylor's karma is sufficiently good for her to be able to find a chameleon on the back end of a Boy George song?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Potentially, maybe. Yeah.
No, Kirsten, I don't think I should sing it. I'm not very good at singing. Brian, would you like to sing it?
I'm also not very good at singing.
No, you see. Karma, 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 karma chameleon, you come and go, oh, you come and go.
Karma, 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 karma chameleon.
Oh. You didn't work, did it, Brian? We'll see.
Maybe around the next corner.
Maybe around the next corner. Right, Taylor's not found a chameleon, but she's got something else terrifying.
Now, I'm not a fan of spiders. However, I have grown fond of the community nest spiders, and it seems as though they are nocturnal. Now, we normally don't see them during the day, and I suspect that maybe they're a bit sensitive to the harsh rays of the sun. But how incredible is this? This entire nest has come alive with hundreds of little spiders. It's actually quite creepy. You can see them all moving around, checking the various areas on the web to see if anybody's got stuck. Now, lucky for them, there are a couple of alates flying around, so I'm waiting for one to get stuck in the web. There already have been a few. And maybe we will see how they rush up to an alate and sort of, well, take it from there. But look at this, very social, all talking to each other. The males and females are very much similar size. There's not too much difference between them. And while they're out here, they'll also be repairing the webs in case a bird or something has flown through their web and got stuck, or a big locust and ripped the webbing and was able to get away. Well, they'll be out repairing them too. Isn't this just incredible? See, checking every single corner. Now, I'm going to quickly scan the web itself because I want to see if I can see an alate. I'm going to put the... What's happening over there? Can you see those ones that I'm shining on up top? No, a little bit higher. I think, look where exactly where the spotlight is going. No, not there, up higher. There's a couple of them that are go down a bit. So we're trying to find, there's a mass of them. There we go. Going to remove the spotlight now. There's an alley. Oh no, it's actually better with the spotlight. Look at that. So they've got one of those termite alleys. And you see how they now come together and work as a team? Oh my goodness, they're going to pull it apart. And they would have bitten into it. You can see that there's one on the right that's latched onto it, injecting venom, which will most likely paralyze or even just kill that alate. But what it will then do is it will that venom will start to act as a digestive aid and actually start digesting that alate's flesh and liquefy it, which will make a easy sort of smoothie for the spiders to feast on. But that is incredible. They're working as a team now to take it back, obviously, to the mound, maybe, or maybe they're just going to find a stronger point of the web. And let's see what they do next. But they're all working hard and they're all bunching up, catching these alates. Maybe they're even fighting over it, because it is quite small. It's not a massive meal for all of them. But don't worry, chaps. There's plenty of alates to go around this evening. Now, there's another one that's caught one and it's on its own. Have a look over there. I think, which one is that? Go a little bit. Oh, there we go. It's going towards it. Oh, no, others have joined up now. And this is what happens. This is why these termites need to release thousands and thousands of alates. It's so that, of course, when 150 of them get stuck on a spider's web, at least there are a couple of others that they can go to. But isn't this just amazing? There we go. There's a bit of a feast. Oh, this is so much better than trying to look at them during the day, don't you think? They are everywhere. I can't believe how many spiders are here. VM, I'm going to move forward a little bit. I want you to just have a look inside the nest. So no. Now, Debbie, you want to actually see how big the nest is. I'm going to reposition. We're going to go forward because I think VM's just behind the nest. How's that, VM? Is that good? Now, look at that. Now, it's quite a big one. It's probably the size of a soccer ball, I would say. And can you see, look at all the spiders that are still inside there that haven't even come out. There must be hundreds, maybe, I don't think quite thousands, but there's definitely a few hundred spiders living in here. Look at that. It's like the entire nest is alive. Oh, those little small ones. You see those little ones moving around? And those hatchlings won't go too far away from the shelter and the nest there, if there are any hatchlings around. And the reason for that is that if they do venture too far out on the web, they also run the risk of being predated. So they'll wait around in the shelter of that leafy nest and all the silk, and perhaps wait and see if the adults will bring some of their prized meals back towards, closer towards the web. It looks like there's a few flies in there as well. I don't know if you saw the green heads. Vicky, you said that these spiders on the termites remind you of the Nkuhumas on a buffalo. It's amazing to see two predators of different species very much behaving in the same way. This is really incredible. I've never seen a nest like this come alive, but I must say I've never actually seen one at night before. I've always sort of overlooked them. And I just want to show you something else. Look here, VM, can you see how they're starting to develop another one? Obviously, the big nest has become overpopulated, and they're even starting to form a secondary nest as well. That's wonderful. They've just got incredible markings on them too. We don't often get to have a good look at these spiders up close like this, and also so relaxed. I know a couple of times I've tried to show you and entice them to come out, but they're too clever for my tricks and normally just poke their heads out, have a look, and then, well, they're not fooled after that. Now, it's interesting to see that they're not really wrapping the termite in silk. It seems as though they're just leaving it there and paralyzing it and then feeding on it, which is quite interesting. I thought that they maybe would have stockpiled the food and taken some of these back inside closer to the mound. Not to the mound, sorry, that's where the termites come out of. But of course, back to that nest. Can you see the trip line, or the big line that's going across to the other side of the tree? Look at that. I've just seen that now. Look how that goes all the way atop, on top of the tree and joining with another tree. Can you see that? There's one going across. Now, that's amazing. And the only way that I can think that they can get their web from one side of the tree to the other is if they use the wind. And perhaps when there's a bit of a breeze, where are they? And they will maybe leap off a leaf and attach a piece of silk to a leaf and then, well, hope that the wind blows them towards the next one, because that's a big gap for such a small spider. Now, these spiders have been fantastic, and I must say, I think that they've been the highlight for me this afternoon, even though I don't like them. You learn to appreciate incredible things like this. Now, that drive went so quickly this afternoon. We're coming down to the final minutes, so I have to say goodbye. But it's been absolutely wonderful, as usual, and I hope to see you bright and early in the morning. So from myself and VM, have a lovely night. But let's head over to James, because he's also got a creepy crawly.
Creepy crawly longhorn beetle. And what I think it's doing is hunting the termites that you can see on their foraging mission going up and down the tree. Are those are ants? I think they're ants, actually. They are ants. They're cocktail ants. So obviously so, because their tails are, Brian?
They are loaded.
Yes, they are cocked. Yes, cocked up cocktail ants. And this longhorn beetle seems to have some sort of stage fright. But you can see he's eyeing them. There's one coming up behind him. Let's see if he nabs it. No? The cocktail ant nearly walked underneath him. So those long feelers of his clearly not doing their jobs. Now he's sitting on a marula tree. I didn't think that ants... Oh, no, they do. Cocktail ants do live in trees. That's right. They've got their nests up in trees. And all around us, we are getting inundated by termite alates, one of which, of course, met its end before it could fulfill its destiny and create a new mound at the hands of those dastardly community nest spiders. Right, we have 3 more minutes. Brian, shall we try and find a chameleon?
Yeah, let's find one.
Let's quickly find one. We'll just quickly go down here and see if we can't find one on the edge of these Combretum bushes. And there are many, many alates flying towards us. You might be able to see them. I'm not sure if you can see. I'm watching my monitor now. There's one. I caught it. I did. It was a moth that flew off. Let's try again. We'll try and get another one. We need to get a net on the end of this. That was great. There's something crawling on my leg. I hope it's not poisonous. This is also, you know, it's a feeling you've got to get used to again in the summertime, everybody. By the end of the summer, you just sort of drive along and, you know, you enjoy the tickling feeling of various kinds of insects living on your legs during the course of a drive. But at the beginning of summer, it's a little bit disconcerting. Sometimes feels a little creepy to have 45 termites, 68 stink bugs and 74 beetles crawling up and down your legs. Don't you find, Brian?
I do.
Yes. I thought you might. Ah, William, I hope you haven't bought a whole book to keep your ant list in. Oops. I don't know if you're still with us. Are you still with us? Okay, sorry, everybody. We had a... As I switched the light off, the screen went. William, the cocktail ant, you say, is your very first ant on your list. Like I say, I hope the book that you're writing your ant list in isn't very long, because I don't know a huge amount about ants, but Steph does. The other obvious ant that we could see is Polyrhynchus. She is my favourite ant. And we are going to just slowly ease our way to a stop here so that Brian can show you the almost full cheesy moon, and I can say goodbye. Thank you, everybody, for coming on our little safari with us today. Thank you, Brian, for your tremendous efforts of putting up with me. To Kirsten and Rebecca in the final control, well done to both of you. And, of course, to T-Twizzle on the other vehicle with Viam, recently back from leave, and with a marvellous haircut he has. It's very impressive, I must say. We will bid you farewell until 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. Stay safe and happy. Bye-bye.